Alrighty, hello everybody. Welcome to another episode of Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy. And you might notice that the title is PSEC 2015, Discussing Energy Conservation. Discussing the topic of energy conservation in a context to which the average person can understand it and be able to see exactly how it applies to them on a personal level. Let me translate to you what that really means. I got a notice in the mail today about fucking smart meters, and I can't really put those sorts of keywords into YouTube, otherwise the frickin' censorship Nazis might come and take down this freaking channel. I already won one Illuminati merit badge with my previous channel. I don't really want to win one with this, so sorry about being a little cryptic, but, you know, the topic and description still does apply. Oh, and I'm getting a message back from Daphne, packing up the boys to leave right now, so I can't make this one keep inviting me because it's been on my mind lately, too. Okay. And it's just Daphne Dugan. I had, you know, invited her to this hangout here. Okay. Next time. Okay, cool. So, anyway, we got the little notice about the smart meters, and smart meters are bad news, and we are going to go into exactly how and why they are bad news. But the first thing I wanted to do when I received this and move forward and into doing it is I wanted to call up ComEd and just kind of politely interrogate them a little bit about what their perspectives are on this and so on and so forth. So I called up the number, and, you know, this lady, you know, she's very polite and everything, but I could tell she was totally, you know, going by a script. And the first thing she asked me, she's like, oh, can I have your name and account number and so on and so forth? I'm like, my name is Dave, and you don't need an account number because I'm simply, you know, calling up to inquire. Just ask some questions about the smart meters and stuff. I'm not looking to make any changes to any sort of accounts or anything. So, you know, hopefully that'll be okay and you could just answer the questions that I have. And, you know, she tried pretty hard to get, you know, an account number. And, you know, I just, you know, was like, no, you don't need that information. I'm just, you know, I'm calling to just ask some questions. So finally, you know, I started, you know, inquiring about it, and I'm like, is there any way to opt out on this? Because, you know, I've done a lot of research on smart meters, and they're kind of bad news, and we don't really want anything to do with those. So, what's the process for opting out? And she said, well, there's really no way to opt out, but there is a delay list. And apparently what this means is that you could have it delayed. You know, they want to have all this done by 2018, but they know they're not going to be able to do that. So you can have it delayed all the way up to the year 2022, which hopefully by then a lot more people will be shifted and, you know, all this will just kind of cancel out anyway once enough people are awake and aware enough. And in order to be on this delay list, you have to pay like an extra $21 a month or something like that, which, you know, that's cool by me, because besides all the other negative effects of these meters and shit, there have been no shortage of reports of how people that get switched to these meters, their electric bill jacks sky high, like astronomically freaking high. So, you know, an extra, you know, $21 is a small price to pay, you know, for not having, you know, my bill jacked into fucking high holy hell. And, you know, I was telling her, you know, about it, and I asked her, I said, you know, you don't have to answer this, of course, I'm just curious, but obviously, you know, you're a human being, and, you know, these meters are, you know, going to affect you as well. I'm curious as to your opinion on it and whether or not you have done any personal research and, you know, looked into the effects of these, just for yourself. And the way she came back with it so immediately and so perfectly, I could tell that these sorts of questions were things they had thought of, and, you know, there was a script to go along with that. And so she was saying, oh, yeah, I researched and you know, I have no problem with the smart meters and da-da-da. And I'm like, oh, well, where did you check? And, like, she listed, you know, two sites. I forgot exactly what they were now, but, you know, they were, shall we say, sites of officialdom. And she made sure to mention, oh, and these sites are not in any way affiliated with ComEd or any of its subsidiaries, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, whatever. So it's like you could tell she was reading from the script. I'm like, okay. And I said, well, you know, 5 minutes in front of Google doesn't count. You know, with all due respect, I'm not trying to be rude or judge you or anything. But, you know, you've got to kind of put hours and hours into it and look at a bunch of different sources and vet the information, not just, you know, skim the first two pages you come across and, you know, call it a day. You know, that's not how you vet in information. And then she was just like, again, another script read off, basically stating that ComEd values its business relationships with its customers and would never want to do anything to sabotage that, you know, in regards to the price hikes and all that. And we would never put in anything that would do any sort of physical harm to our customers, and, you know, and we would not lie to you about this and da-da-da-da-da. And I said, well, I used to work as a customer service representative, and they told us to lie to the customers about things all the time. And they told us that if we didn't lie to the customer, that we'd be fired. So I can neither confirm nor deny whether or not you've been told to lie. I can't claim that you have, and I can't claim that you have not. But I do know that when I was working as a customer service representative, it was common practice to lie to the customer. They told us we had to, otherwise we could lose our job. And she was just like, you could tell she was really uneasy with the entire conversation. And right now it seems that the main battlefront here in Illinois for these smart meters is Naperville, Illinois. And there's been a lot of nasty, you know, police state stuff going on down there. You know, there's a couple of people that were arrested for, you know, refusal for, you know, saying, hey, I don't want you to put these things on here. And, you know, they got arrested for it, and it was a total kangaroo court. And it was a fucking joke. And so they're trying to, you know, there's an organization down there that's against this stuff and trying to push forward a class action lawsuit and so on and so forth. So it'll be pretty interesting. So within this particular hangout, I'm actually going to play through some of the videos, and we're going to read off some of the articles and things so that we can condense this as much as possible so we're not getting too long-winded. So beyond that, all me and Rich are going to do is, you know, we're going to express our thoughts on the content that, you know, we're looking at. And we're also going to show you some interesting things that I discovered that, you know, you could do kind of in defense. Like there's some form notifications and things like that that you can place in spots. And I'll get into those details very shortly. I'm being vague about it now just to push through this intro and get into the main content. So before I start going into videos, Rich, what are your thoughts on smart meters?
Well, to me, smart meters are just kind of another form of state-controlled tyranny like anything else, you know. There's no real set purpose for them. They're just there to monitor what you use and, you know, they can detect what, you know, they say they can detect, you know, the difference between a computer and an air conditioning unit. I mean, they get information that's just way too private, and, you know, it's just kind of a hack on privacy, and really, in a sense, it's a violation of the Fourth Amendment in and of itself, because they're sending these workers out on your property without any notification. They're putting in these little meters that give out all this electromagnetic radiation that poisons your health and, you know, causes real problems for people, and it's been documented to do so. And I mean, there's really no applicable use for a smart meter besides to, you know, control electricity and monitor what you're doing and what you're using. But really, it's not, you know, it's not like the power companies are completely invincible. I mean, you know, there's not only can you put, are there countermeasures you can take, you know, like no trespassing signs. If you really want to get physical, you can go down to your local, you know, hardware store, you know, your local electronic hardware store, plumbing store, and you can get an old-fashioned analog meter. And I've seen YouTube videos on it where they literally cut the locks off that the power company puts on their little smart meters. You can take the smart meter out of the plug hole, and you can put the old-fashioned analog meters back in. So, I mean, there's ways you can kind of tell them to shove their smart meters up their butt, you know. I mean, there's no... They can't, it's not like they have armed guards next to those things. So, I mean, there's ways you can fight back, and you can lock up your own meter and make sure that, you know, they're not just going to be able to get back there and tamper with your stuff, you know. To change a meter, you know, back to what it originally was isn't stealing electricity, it's just protecting your health and your livelihood. So, you know, if the power company gives you crap for that, well, they're just kind of asking for a lawsuit.
Well, the only problem is, you know, people are being arrested for exactly those sorts of things, so I can't really endorse anybody go ahead and do that, because chances are you probably will get arrested. So if you want to make a statement in doing that against the power companies, then be prepared to pay the freight of, you know, the court proceedings and being arrested and going through all the hassle, because that will happen to you. I'm not going to... You know, I'm not going to act as if it won't, because it totally will. So if you want to go to that level of activism, you can, but be prepared to be arrested and have your day in court.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it really depends on the geographical area. Obviously, in Illinois, they're really getting draconian and kind of Orwellian with it, and, you know, bringing in police officers and getting people arrested and put through court trials, and, you know, power companies suing people over it, and, yeah, so definitely there's going to be risk to, you know, taking their smart meter down and, you know, putting in an old one, you know, as a replacement for it. There's definitely going to be risks to it. It's just, you know, I mean, it's 6.5 one way, half dozen the other. Either they kill you with electromagnetic, you know, radiation and all the other crap that gets emitted from those smart meters, or, you know, you can stand up and do something about it and, you know, make a scene, you know. And the more people that do stuff like that, I mean, what's the power company going to do? You know, they're going to sue every person in the United States who, you know, steps up to the plate and, you know,
removes their crap. Well, thankfully, we're going to be suggesting some measures here shortly for ways you can take your stand without ending up behind bars, but yeah.
I'm just giving the direct, you know, if you want to do a direct approach, you know, if you're a DIY kind of person that likes to do it yourself, you know, you can be smart and avoid being arrested just surely by wits and just, you know, telling these little Nazis who come on your property and say, no, you have to have this meter, you can go, no, I don't. According to these laws, you know, you can slap stickers up, you can be very informative to them, so they really have no excuse as to why not, you know, as to why they can, you know, put their little Nazi meters in and then, you know, arrest you, you know. There's a smart way about going it. Obviously, I'm not, you know, suggesting like you do, like there was this one woman down in Houston who pulled a gun on one of those guys. I don't suggest you do stuff like that. That's not what I'm saying. You shouldn't do things like that, you know. But you should definitely be smart, and you should definitely, you know, make sure that they know you're informed of your rights. And if you're adamant about standing your ground and you inform them, hey, you can't be doing this for these reasons, and, you know, you lock your analog meters up and make sure that everything's A-OK, there's not really anything they can do to you, not unless they're in a bad mood and really, you know, they want to take you down. But, like I said, it really depends on the area and it depends on the kind of people you're dealing with. In some parts of the country, you can get away.
If you try to physically stop them in any way, which includes locking up your meter, if you try doing that sort of thing, you know, they'll just call the police and the cops will be on the side of the draconian electric company and you'll get locked up. But as I said,
it really depends on the area. I mean, yeah, in Chicago, you're going to be dealing with corrupt, you know, piggly police officers who, you know, really don't care. But I'm talking about, you know, out west in areas where you're going to have cops that are going to have a little bit more discernment and aren't just going to be like, oh, yeah, no, he's right, you know. And, you know, it just really depends on the area of the country you're living in. Yeah, if you're living in Chicago, Illinois, I wouldn't suggest, you know. Because, yeah, more than likely, you're going to get arrested because Illinois is famous for its grafted corruption. But in an area like here, you know, where the police officers are more level-headed and are more on the side of the people because they themselves are more connected to the people, you're probably going to have a better chance of success. It just really depends on where you live and, you know, what your neighborhood looks like and what kind of police officers you're dealing with. But if you're dealing with the type of pigs who come kicking your door down because you refuse to do something that you have complete legal rights in refusing, I wouldn't really suggest doing it. But I'm just stating, you know, if you want to get back in the power company's face, there are direct approaches and direct actions in which you can, you know, do those things, and you can get in their face. And Dave, if you want to go into some of the ulterior motives of how you can be smart in the more police state inclined areas, that would be, you know, I'll hand it over to you.
Well, obviously that delay list is definitely one of the things you can do, and it sure beats the hell out of, you know, all the other confrontational stuff, and it beats the hell out of getting completely jacked. Granted, the delay list is still a form of extortion. You're paying them protection money to not come in and fuck with you. It's very mafia in that way. But there's a site here, and I've got all this on Facebook, as you guys can hopefully see, that goes into some of the details. This one, can you see how there's a public notice attached to the meter? Is that showing up?
Yes.
Okay. So on this site, jerryday.com, it shows the public notice, and there's, you know, as I scroll down, you're going to see it to where, you know, you could copy and paste it and whatever into a Word document and, you know, whatever you want to do. And here it is, and I'm just going to read what it says, or unless you want to read what it says. I know you like to play narrator.
Okay, I can read it. Public notice, no smart meter or any similar device may be installed on this property. Warning, major liability and obligation. Any person who acts or conspires to install or apply any device or system upon this property for the purpose or having the effect of monitoring of any activity, collecting data and or emitting electromagnetic, radio or microwave radiation will be charged and prosecuted to the full extent of the law for trespass, assault, wiretapping, stalking, and unlawful surveillance, public endangerment, pollution, damage of property values, and willful violation of prior and rightful notice of contract. Additionally, any actual or attempted installation described above will cause obligation of $1 million due again upon each installation or attempted installation. installation owed and due from every individual and agency fully and separately who may be responsible or complicit in approving or causing the installation. By this notice, any party installing or attempting to install such device or system without fully announcing himself or herself, without identifying himself or herself, and or without obtaining a fully informed written consent for all such installations from the owner and occupants of the property will be concealing activity known by him or her to be criminal in nature and acting in intentional and willful malfeasance against the innocent parties for personal benefit, gain, and advantage, and will become voluntarily liable and obligated to all terms and conditions, declarations, stipulations herein. Effective January 1st, 2000, this posted notice, offer, contract, and reservation of all legal and natural rights with full remedies owed upon any breach or violation. This notice supersedes and replaces all conflicting contracts, current and prior, commission of any act described herein, acceptance of contract. This notice is and will be enforced by all applicable federal, state laws and policies and local ordinances, including but not limited to United States Code Title 47, Chapter 5, Subchapter
6.
Section 605, United States Code Title 42, Chapter 82, Subchapter 7, Section 6973, California Commercial Code, Section 1202, 1304, and 1305.
Obviously, if you're not in California, you wouldn't be using that part. Now, that ends that notice. And then this next one is the one to snail mail to your electric company. This is if you want to prevent installation, et cetera, copy, paste, edit, print, send the letter below by certified mail to the CEO or president of your power company. You know, change the part in italics to specific pertinent information. Keep the original and the certified mail recipients, in other words, the original document that you do up, keep the original and mail up a copy. If anyone calls or threatens to install a digital meter, show them a copy of your letter and proof of service certified mail receipt and tell them that the installation of a digital meter is criminal trespass and you will call the police and request they be taken into custody and you will file a criminal complaint with the police. If they respond in writing, respond back and remind them that they have not proven they may lawfully install any radiation-emitting surveillance device on your property. And now you can go ahead and read this, obviously, to from date of letter, da-da-da, and here we go. Go ahead.
Notice of no consent to trespass or surveillance and radiation pollution, notice of liability, adhesion contract. Dear CEO, name of power company, name, blah, 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 all agents, officers, employees, contractors, and interested parties. In regard to your possible intention to install a smart meter or other digital utility meter at the above address, those meters violate the law and cause endangerment to users and the public due to the following factors. They individually identify electrical devices and record when they are operated, causing an invasion of privacy. They monitor household activity and occupy in violation of the rights of domestic privacy. They transmit wireless signals which are interceptable by unauthorized and distant parties. No power company or other individual or agency has consent to conduct surveillance or monitoring or to emit radiation EMR on a property with digital meter. Data about the occupants' daily habits and activities are collected by digital meters, recorded and stored in permanent databases which are accessed by parties not authorized or invited to know and share that private data. Those with access to the data can review a permanent history of household activities taken and viewed unlawfully and without consent of the occupants and subjects of the surveillance. Those databases may be shared with or fall into the hands of unauthorized law enforcement, private hackers, wireless transmissions, and other unidentified parties for the use against interests of the energy subscribers and the occupants of the structures. Smart meters are by definition surveillance devices which violate federal and state wiretapping laws by recording and storing databases of private and personal activities and behaviors recorded without consent or knowledge of those people who are monitored. It is possible, for example, with analysis of certain smart meter data for unauthorized and distant parties to determine medical conditions, sexual activities, physical locations, persons within the home, vacancy patterns, general affluence, trade secrets, and personal habits of occupants. Digital meters caused by international transmission transmission and or incidental disruption of house current and cancer-causing electromagnetic radiation to be emitted and in proximity of the installed location and property in violation of laws against public endangerment, assault, and commission of bodily harm. Digital meters are designed to transmit using electromagnetic radiation known to cause cancer and many other diseases, illnesses, and symptoms. For the above reasons and by right of the occupancy of property ownership, I prohibit and deny consent of any installation and use of any monitoring, eavesdropping, surveillance, and radiation-emitting devices on my property and place of residence, especially in the form of an electric meter. Any attempt to install such device directed at me or other occupants on my property or residence will constitute trespass, stalking, wiretapping, and assault, all prohibited and punishable by law for criminal and civil actions. All persons, government agencies, and private organizations responsible for installing, operating, and monitoring devices which I consider to be unlawful will be fully liable for major financial compliance claims and demands in excess for $1 million. This is legal notice. Oh. Well, they could have said this is a legal notice, whatever.
It's spoken in legalese. This is legal notice. Like, you know.
Okay, whatever. There's two ways to say it. This is legal notice. The liabilities and obligations listed above are true and binding upon all parties upon delivery of this notice. These terms and conditions apply without regard to status or existence of any opt-out contract. Utility service may not be denied for refusal of unlawful conduct by the utility company. Wow, that's definitely a typo. Cop-m-honey.
Yeah.
Company. For the act of self-defense, under my authority as owner and or occupant of the above property and under the implied and expressed application to enter that property, this is an adhesion contract which you are now bound until and unless you respond with factual rebuttal in a sworn statement by an authorized and identified party within 21 days of this delivery. Any rebuttal must show your authority to install an unlawful radiation-emitting surveillance device and digital electric meter on my property without my consent. Expect rebuttal to any such claim. Any failure to timely show and prove full binding authority to install the unlawful and harmful device on my property and or place of occupancy will be in agreement with all terms and conditions herein. We deny and refuse any past, present, and future proposal, offer, demand, or claim contrary to the terms of or conditions herein. This notice to principal is notice to agent, and notice to agent is principal. Notice to principal, all rights reserved, signature of any user and or customer, energy user and or customer, name of any, whatever.
Yeah. You get the idea. So it's totally lawyered up, you might say. Total legalese, except for a few little typos and stuff, but, you know, these are two, the sign on the meter and this letter is, you know, it's two things you could do. It's not a cure-all. I forgot which founding father or otherwise, you know, popular early American figure said this, but it was something to the effect of the idea that, you know, it's pretty much gonna be a sad day if, you know, when people are under the notion that written legislation prevents crime. That, you know, that somehow just because something is written down on paper with ink, that it can prevent, you know, physical circumstances and physical harm. That's a delusion that a lot of people, you know, have come under. Oh, well, they can't do that because it's the law. They can do whatever the fuck they want. They're the damn Gestapo. They don't have to obey their laws. They break their own laws all the damn time. So, this merely shows the ruling authority, our slave masters, it shows them that we're waking up and that we are willing to defend ourselves in a civil way. So it kind of spooks them, you know, the more of these they get, they're thinking, oh crap, you know, the more we push this, the more people will wake up and the more people might do the same thing. Because let's face it, let's say a million people in Chicago all at the same time decided to say no to these meters. Well, people forget that it takes manpower and resources to do things like arrest people. There's got to be jails to put them in. There's got to be courthouses and personnel to process the case, so on and so forth. I mean, if you've got a million people at once saying no, there aren't going to be enough cops in the city to process all those people, much less jails to put them in, much less lawyers, much less judges, much less clerk personnel. Can you imagine the paperwork nightmare alone if all of a sudden, you know, a million pieces of paperwork just flooded into the system? You know, if that were even possible to physically take all those people and stick them somewhere, if you could even get to that point, can you imagine the paperwork nightmare that would grind the system to a halt? There'd be no way to process it. Mm-hmm. So this just kind of freaks them out to that idea, like, oh man, you know, this many people are aware and are doing this sort of stuff and sending us this sort of stuff, so if we go against them, then that wakes up even more people. I mean, without getting that smart meter notice, I wouldn't have looked into all this stuff this deeply. I mean, I already knew about the dangers of smart meters and stuff, but I basically said I'll cross that bridge when I come to it when we get the notice in the mail. Well, the notice is here, so, you know, I'm rolling into action in 2015, in the year of action. And, you know, so now I'm looking deeper and just, like, finding all this out all this interesting information stuff you can do. And, it you know, it totally makes sense. So, you know, obviously, if all of this stuff inspires people like me to look this information up and to act on it and to make videos like this and put it out there, you know, it spreads like wildfire. If only 10 people ever watch this video and take it seriously, they might take the information from the video and each inspire another 10, who then each inspire another 10, so on and so forth. So that sort of thing spreads really virally, especially when people get pissed. It's like that guy said on that movie, The Network, which I've never actually seen that movie. I should watch that one of these days. You've got to get mad. Doesn't mean stay mad forever and become so mad and in a rage that you're drunk on it and that your critical thinking goes out the window and you're useless. I'm just saying that people getting momentarily pissed off at a fucking outrage like this is kind of that splash of water on the face that tells people, oh, well, maybe we need to do something about it. It's that bitch slap. Doesn't mean that bitch slap has to you know, beat you into the ground until you're brain dead, but that momentary wake-up call kind of gets people going, whoa, wait a minute. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, it's the internal survival instinct, you know? It's the same kind of thing that the Patriots had. It's the same kind of thing that revolutionaries throughout history have had. You know, they just, it's that moment of, you know, the straws breaking the camel's back. You know, it's just kind of like, okay, we're done. We're taking the gloves off. You know, it's time to do something, not just sit on our butts complacent, just going, oh, well, you know, trying to justify it. Because eventually it gets to a certain point where there is no justification for it. It's, you know, it's complete and utter invasion of privacy. It's utter invasion of, you know, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, you know. And the globalists will only succeed in their goals as long as people remain stupid and complacent to their, you know, and fearful of repercussions if they act out. It's the only way they're going to have any power is if they remain fearful, complacent, and dumb.
Yeah.
You know.
And, you know, all of our particular beliefs and ideologies and stuff aside, I mean, obviously the main point of this video is to give you the facts, both legal and scientific. So obviously we just gave you a few legal courses of actions, and with this the video and other data that we're about to present, obviously, you know, we're going to go into more of the science of that. I mean, I don't want you to believe or disbelieve me if you're new to this subject. You know, believe nothing, disbelieve nothing, question everything. You know, do your own research, use your own discernment. Don't believe me just because I'm saying it, and don't disbelieve me just because you're under the notion that people like me are kooks that don't know what they're talking about or whatever. Because a truly, someone who is credible, like, you know, someone who is truly credible is going to be somebody who says, okay, let's look at the information and see where it goes. People who I deem to be completely non-credible, regardless of what they say, I just look at them and laugh, and I'm like, dude, you know, everything you say to me is worthless, are the people who are like, no, fuck you. You're stupid to say that. I'm not going to look at your stupid evidence because it's stupid and you're all stupid. You're a kook and you're just dumb. And I know that these things don't hurt anybody, and you're just being all stupid. You know, I've seen quite a few responses like that on the internet. And like, those people's opinions don't even bother me in the same way that if a 3-year-old was saying the same thing to me, I would just, you know, look at him and smile and be like, okay, well, they're a 3-year-old. They don't really know about smart meters or anything like that. They don't even know how to hold a rational discussion yet. And Katarina is chiming in here on Facebook. She's asking with who? Me and... I got a notice in the mail. I just heard a weird chime. Katarina saying, ah, no thanks. Okay. See you later. Anyway. So yeah, now we're going to go into our first video here. Oh, and you can find... okay, and Katarina responded with a little image picture thingy there. Not an animated one, though. Anyway... You could find this video here on the Paradigm Shift in Educational Comedy on Facebook, and I've got all the relevant links and stuff posted in the comments section, so you can just kind of check that out. You know, you can go into the video section here on the side. If by the time you look at this, this is no longer pinned to the top, and maybe it's months later or something, you can always go just, you know, on the side here into the video section and, you know, click in and, you know, get at it that way, because all the stuff's going to stay in the comments. So here we go on the first one.
We are now entering the brave new world of smart meters. That means your electric meter will do so much more than just show how much electricity you use. The new smart meters are watching you. They sense all kinds of goings-on. They see when you turn something on or off. They see how many watts your electric toothbrush pulls. They send the record of that little event over wireless networks, bouncing through your neighbor's smart meters all the way to the power company, where they keep record of all your electric consumption volumes and patterns every minute of every day and store that data forever on computers that you'll never get to see. That data shows when you are at home, shows when you're sleeping, shows when you're on vacation, when you have visitors, when you use a lamp, a power tool, some extra computers, and if you look like you're running a business out of your home. It even senses when you bootleg energy off the grid. Your smart meter data shows a vivid profile of your personal living patterns and whether or not you were at home on the night of the murder. This is not electrical metering. This is personal surveillance. This is a search without a warrant every day. This is your personal private life going straight out through your electric meter to the power company, to the government, to the police, to the insurance company, to anyone who cuts a deal with your power company to look at your life under a microscope. Sorry, it's actually worse than that. People who don't cut a deal can get your information too by simply intercepting the wireless signal spewing from the side of your house. Yes, smart meters are radio transmitters. Here's how you tell. This one is a 1-watt radio station licensed by the FCC. On this all-news radio station, every detail of your electrical life is shooting off to some institutional data center somewhere. Already, the police in Ohio, Texas, British Columbia, and places I don't know about are regularly using smart meter data to pinpoint marijuana grow houses, enforce business licenses, and punish people for doing things in the privacy of their own homes that you were not supposed to do, but they wouldn't even know you were doing if they weren't spying on you. Your power company apparently gets to sell your personal life story to whomever it wants. Any unusual power consumption pattern is considered probable cause to raid you for growing marijuana or running a computer server without a business license. This is about as big brother as it gets. Those friendly men with their truckload of smart meters are going door to door with something a little different than a Christmas carol. My personal opinion is that you and I need to demand that these things be taken off our homes. It is not possible for your power company to claim they have the right to install a surveillance device on your house. Smart meters are no different from wiretapping devices. And in case you didn't know, wiretapping is illegal in all 50 of the states and the federal territories. If you let your power company put a smart meter on your house, you may as well walk around all day with a Facebook helmet webcam pointed at yourself. They have convinced themselves installing smart meters is lawful by some reaching to the moon jive called implied consent. If you say they can change your meter, they pretend you consent even when you don't know really what they're doing. Here's a tip. Tell them they can't change your meter. They had no trouble billing you with the old meter. If you send them a notice by certified mail that they may not install a smart meter or any other surveillance device on your house, their implied consent goes out the window. I would do that if I were you. In fact, I did that, and I'm not even you. You can see a copy of my letter in the drop-down next to this video. You can copy and paste that into your word processor. Make sure and change the info into your own info. The post office will give you the certified mail slip. Those friendly guys on the sidewalk told me that they plan to put a smart meter on every house in America. If they do that, it will no longer be America.
Any thoughts on that so far?
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much right on, you know. That pretty much, yeah, in a short manner of speaking, kind of sums it up, you know. It's complete invasion of privacy, and they know it, and they're just counting on the ignorance of folk to not call them on it, you know. Fortunately, I live in a part of the country where they haven't, you know, brought in that kind of stuff because there's just too many people around here who would fuss about it. But, yeah, it's definitely a problem that needs to be confronted and it needs to be dealt with because, you know, if they start figuring that they can do it in big cities, it won't be too much longer before they start figuring they can do it out in the rural areas too. So, yeah. The line has got to be drawn in the sand somewhere, and, you know, it sounds like in some ways it already is, but, you know, it still sounds like there's more that needs to be done, which, you know, that's given with any situation in the current state of humanity. But, yeah, he was definitely right on.
Although, of course, there might be some people we know that might say that this video against smart meters is a thesis, antithesis, synthesis, problem, reaction, solution video, because I supposedly work for the CIA and I recruit people for false flags or whatever the fuck any crazy person likes to fucking say when they're butthurt because they don't like something I said. You know who I'm talking about.
No, not gonna say any names, but I definitely know.
We'll just say the William Blacks of the world. Although William Black didn't say it like exactly like that, but there is someone who did say it exactly like that. But I'm not gonna reveal that information because I'm not a smart meter.
Exactly.
I'm a dumb meter. I just spew dumbness. These videos are stupid.
Dark shadow guy.
Yeah, there we go. I'm a dark shadow guy, especially on the toilet. You know, the shadow just comes over the bowl, and then the bombardment of biological weapons into the bowl.
We are strangest global events of our lifetimes. Power companies in the USA, Canada, Europe, Japan, and who knows where else, who have no business other than to safely deliver utility services to us, have been enlisted by some global agenda to install radiation-emitting surveillance devices on our homes that they are calling smart meters. The reason that this is so strange is that even after we have told them that these devices are dangerous, harmful, unlawful, and invasive, they flatly ignore us and continue to attempt the installations as if we were speaking to a hole in the ground. We know now that our power companies were perfectly aware of the problems with these meters from the beginning, and they even developed and planned strategies to withhold information about the meters, to install the devices without our knowledge or consent, to lie to us about what the digital meters are and what they do, and refuse to provide verifiable answers to questions about those meters. They could not have sent a more clear signal that the meters are not in our interest. Our power companies have allowed themselves to become partisans and to become enemies of their customers' health, safety, and privacy in some strange and new program to collect data and possibly harm everyone who has a utility meter. The new digital meters are designed to do things utility meters don't need to do, and power companies refuse to explain why they are so determined to push this on us. Most of us have become very dependent on our utilities, and our dependency is now being exploited by a global matrix called the smart grid, designed for massive collection and centralization of personal data. Because this smart grid program operates largely in secret, there are many theories emerging and being explored. This is not limited to just your power company or even your country. It's clearly coordinated internationally. United Nations Agenda 21 has become suspected as a key driver because that agenda calls for global controls of population behaviors and collection of data at the local level, just as the digital meters are designed to do. Those United Nations programs have been directly funded by proponents of global governance and depopulation, such as Ted Turner, Bill Gates, George Soros, and other members of secret societies advocating depopulation, such as the Club of Rome. Again, this is currently largely rumor and speculation, and we certainly need more facts to fully understand the bizarre experiment of invading private homes all over the world with high-tech monitoring devices posing as utility meters. Depopulation agenda or not, digital utility meters offer no benefit whatsoever to customers and pose a number of very serious hazards. It's hard to imagine the forces and pressures that could have enlisted your power companies in the smart meter program, because broad-scale deployment of those meters exposes the power companies to huge negative legal and political consequences. Because of the secret character of the smart meter rollout, utility customers have been caught very much off guard. that have made some mistakes on how we respond to this assault. We have protested and demonstrated. We have pleaded and argued with the utility company to remove the meters. We have asked the utility company to provide solutions, assuming they would want to. We have failed to recognize that the problem is much larger than mismanagement of a utility company. We have a determined public enemy at a level above our utility companies. The power company is a low or mid-level player, and they are playing on the wrong side. This forces us into a different relationship with our utility companies. You don't negotiate with criminals. You don't let them commit a little bit of crime along with an essential public service. Crime is crime. The only thing that crime calls for is enforcement, and unfortunately, as is so common these days, none of our public agencies seem to be willing or able to enforce safe utility metering for us, and we have no choice but to enforce for ourselves. Enforcement is very different from petitioning an institution for better service or responsible conduct. We must let go of our consumer mentality and adopt the mentality of an enforcer. Enforcement means force. It means command. It means using leverage, strategy, and power in a targeted way against a determined opponent. If you want your home in the future to be free of excess electromagnetic radiation and monitoring devices, there are some strategic and targeted strategies that I can suggest. First, never compromise with a violator. Never negotiate your rights, safety, and health away. Giving up those things damages you. What that means in the struggle against digital utility metering is never agree to any harmful or unclear proposal that has been devised by your utility company. Do not regard the company as your friend. They may offer to violate you a little less and call it an opt-out. They actually have the gall to demand payments for not violating you. There is no word for that but extortion. It would be unbelievable if it wasn't actually happening. In California, in February of 2012, Pacific Gas and Electric and the California Public Utilities Commission decided, without any consensus from or even disclosure to most utility customers, that all Californians should pay a large fee up front and monthly fees forever for the privilege of not having a more expensive electric meter that emits cancer-causing radiation and conducts surveillance on private activities inside the home. Never before have these utilities and regulators lost their reason and common sense to the point where they have attempted to charge people for not having something. The logic is amazing. I guess this is what they're thinking. They expect to make huge new revenues by charging you for what they call time of day usage. Because their meters will be spying on your daily and hourly energy consumption behavior, they can attach fees and penalties to behavior they deem to be undesirable. If you refuse to accept the smart meter that enables them to raise all these fees, they want a way to get the revenues anyway, by simply charging you fees for not having the meter. And amazingly, regulators failed to see the plain criminal idiocy of such a scheme. This represents a major new paradigm in the exploitation of utility customers. It's astonishing that utility companies and regulators even imagined they could get away with such an assault on the basic rights of utility customers, and to presume that no one would resist, object, or hold them accountable for violating the public interest in such a blatant and contrived way. Public officials and utility administrators can be imprisoned for this if we and our justice system step up to the task. So that's the first strategy. Never accept any shady, half-criminal opt-out offer from your power company. The next strategy is even more powerful. Basically, it is collecting evidence. Evidence is what wins in a legal conflict. Many people are experiencing sudden and unusual health problems going on for weeks or months, only to realize they started on the day the smart meter was installed. If a digital meter is ever installed on your home or workplace, keep a diary of all the changes in the occupant's health from the day that meter is installed. Write down the time, the day, the name of the victim, and the description of the symptoms or problems. Just from doing a few videos on smart meters, I've received many dozens of calls from people with horror stories about their digital meters. The story usually goes something like this. My kids and I were getting sick. The doctors couldn't figure out what was causing it. Then we realized it all started at the same time they installed our smart meter. Headaches, nausea, insomnia, lack of concentration, heart palpitations, mood swings, depression, confusion, poor performance at work or school, sick days, lost jobs, family dysfunctions and conflicts, disintegrating relationships. These are all things that should be written down and described with time and date. You'll find that you'll have a powerful legal device there. You can bring that as a sworn statement before your utility company or a court, and they will have no way to dispute or rebut that with firsthand knowledge. You have just created compelling and prevailing evidence in any legal contest. It's more important than you may know. Without that diary, you have little or no recourse against the costs to your health and your family that a digital utility meter may cause. Simply having that record gives you the legal power and advantage to leverage the future your way and to defeat the violator. The power company, who thinks it doesn't have to listen and respond to your demand for safety, health, and privacy. The public is awakening to this issue. Our opinions and our voices are changing the political equation in the digital meter invasion. But this is no small program, and we will have to be heard. All of us will have to be heard if we wish to protect our health, safety, and privacy. That's the strategy for now. Refuse the installations, refuse the opt-outs, and keep records of any problems the digital meters are causing you. Those are the best protections we can have right now that I could think of. In an odd way, this digital meter problem is a helpful signal. It is clear now that we need to take action to get electromagnetic radiation and institutional surveillance out of our lives.
This guy's about 98% totally on the ball. As for the 2%, he is a bit old paradigm, so here's a new paradigm idea. Take the opt-out. It's only like $21 a month. And then the only time I would agree with him on not taking the opt-out is don't take the opt-out if you're going to take it and then be a fucking pussy and do nothing. If you take the opt-out, talk about it. Post videos on YouTube. Raise awareness. This is the year of action, 2015. And then you can get paid from YouTube. Monetize the video. You're damn right I'm going to be monetizing this one. I make money from YouTube. There's nothing wrong with making money by putting out free videos for people to freely watch. And plus, you're raising awareness. So if you're being charged $20 a month to opt out, but you're making $100 a month or more because you're talking about the fact that you're opting out, well then, in an odd, ironic way, the electric company has just done you a favor and made you some money. So not only do you not get to get sick with radiation and all that, but you get to make a few bucks, ironically, courtesy of the electric company.
Uh-huh.
So he's not seeing it from the new paradigm point of view, which is okay. He's an older guy, and it is hard to teach an old dog new tricks sometimes. But it is good that even the older guys are waking up to the tyranny and the bullshit. A lot of the baby boomers were indoctrinated by the Brady Bunch and Leave It to Beaver and, you know, Dobie Gillis and Patty Duke and whatever else. I mean, I love those shows. They're great, and they're great if you realize that they are fantasy and fiction. But back in the day when they were out, people took those very seriously. That was what they thought reality was. Golly gee! Oh, Humpy Doo! Oh, Mr. Wilson, you gave me a quarter. I'm so happy. And, you know, this placated, complicit, you know, 50s sitcom, you know, Orwellian paradise where everybody's always happy and smiling, and there's an Orwellian moral to the story about how you're a good little boy or girl when you just smile and obey and whatever, this is what soaked into the children's heads in the 1950s. So this is a part of their programming today. And it can be a real bitch to step outside of that. So I commend any of them who have, to any extent, stepped outside of that box and realized that that box is a load of shit. But just because they stepped out of it doesn't necessarily mean that some old habits won't still be ingrained. It is harder for them to think in new paradigm terms. But a lot of them are trying, so I commend them for that. At least they get an E for effort, and they're doing a lot more than most people. So now on to the next one. Unless you have something else to say. I got a bunch of really cool things to show here.
No. Anything? No. Yep, we're on the same page, so.
Alrighty, here's the next one.
Yeah, but I'm a one-to-man. No, I'm not digging into it. You wanted to come
and fix problems in the future. I don't think the... even if you cut it, I don't think they're going to buy anything.
You ready?
Yep.
Okay, so once again, we have Feed Ginny Power here. One leg, second leg, both legs, and we have... No power here, one leg here. Therefore, problem is here. And we've been waiting 8 hours for PG&E, so fuck them.
Just one example of how smart these meters are not. That's what I was talking to you about earlier as far as, you know, the software on there is what controls whether or not power is actually flowing through. So, these things, besides being harmful and a ripoff or a dysfunctional piece of shit to begin with, here's a nice little news thing. CBS 5 investigation.
This is CBS 5 Eyewitness News.
Do you have one of those new PG&E smart meters? They're supposed to help you understand your energy use, but we've heard from many viewers who think smart meters are anything but. CBS 5 investigative reporter Anna Warner looked into them. Anna.
Well, Dana, if you don't have smart meters yet, you will, and there's no choice. They'll be installed in all Bay Area homes by 2012. But some viewers are asking us to investigate this. If the meters are so great, why do their bills seem to be going up? Tonight, we put the questions to PG&E and get some surprising answers. They're the new electronic meters PG&E is installing on every home in the Bay Area, called smart meters.
They're an absolute critical, necessary first step.
A first step, says PG&E's Andrew Tang, toward a new way of monitoring your energy use.
Now we don't need to send people to go to individual homes and to read meters every time.
Instead, PG&E will be able to read these meters remotely, and not just by the month, but by the hour. And they say they'll be able to control your usage remotely, too. So if there's a heat wave, they can turn your air conditioning down from a distance, which they say may avoid rolling blackouts and reduce the need for expensive power plants. In the long run, PG&E even promises smart meters will help customers know when to conserve energy so they can save money.
I do believe bills will go down.
But so far, many customers say the result has been just the opposite.
Her bill was $873.
When PG&E rolled out the meters in the Central Valley last summer,
what we saw is an outcry from folks from Bakersfield to Fresno.
After listening to those complaints, Senate Majority Leader Dean Flores told us,
I think PG&E has been less than truthful.
What about the explanations Flores says the company gave some of those customers, like telling them their old meters just weren't as accurate as the smart meters?
There's no doubt that PG&E has lied to its customers when it comes to replacing the old meters with the new meters and somehow saying that the old meters were defective.
Something Tang now admits isn't true. Should PG&E customer service representatives be saying to somebody, well, it's probably just that your old meters weren't accurate?
No, they shouldn't. The customer service response, I think, is not consistent.
Tang blames the Central Valley's higher bills primarily on a hotter-than-normal summer. But if that's the case, why have there been complaints all over the Bay Area? Like in Pittsburgh, where Jennifer Kovanec's bill jumped from $80 to $329.
It just went up.
Or in Brentwood, where homeowner Steve Moon says,
I got a bill in December for $1,107. There's got to be a mistake.
No mistakes, says PG&E. After reviewing their accounts, the company says their meters were working correctly, just like those of the 1,500 other Californians who complained.
Out of that 1,500, we haven't found any issues.
But consumer advocate Mindy Spatz says that still doesn't explain something else.
Customers with the smart meters claim that their energy usage has inexplicably risen since the meters were put in.
So in other words, it makes it look like all of a sudden they're using twice as much energy as they used to use.
Exactly.
Like Concord's Bill Galvin.
When you start getting bills like this, I mean, it just blows a person away.
He doesn't use his gas furnace much. His thermostat stays at 62 degrees, and his bill used to run about $100. But after he got a gas smart meter...
The last bill I received is $380, and how come, I don't know.
But when Galvin called PG&E to tell them something was clearly wrong...
All they would tell me is you're using too much power. They don't want to try to deal with you.
But after we asked PG&E, a crew went out to his house to check and found that smart meter was incorrectly installed.
We're incredibly sorry that this happened. This shouldn't have happened. Mr. Galvin's case is really one of the first cases that we found.
So you're saying Mr. Galvin has the only meter with a problem?
We are to date. This is, you know, Mr. Galvin's case, is unique. It's the first one that we've seen.
And as to the other complaints of higher bills, Tang says many consumers simply don't realize that rates have gone up.
If there was a failing on our part, it was a communication failing on the rate increase.
What do you think went wrong there?
We didn't communicate anything about rate increases.
And one of the reasons for those rate increases, the $2.2 billion needed to put in those smart meters.
First people paying into this should have been the utilities, not the consumer.
From the consumer perspective, what am I getting from my investment in the meter? Right now, it seems like consumers have got nothing but trouble.
Well, PG&E maintains that the overall complaint rate for smart meters isn't different from that of the old meters, and that these complaints reflect a typical pattern of summer and winter complaints about high bills. But given what we found with Bill Galvin's gas meter, the company says it's now changing its processes for checking meter performance. That one, they say, was a, quote, big mistake. The PUC also says they're investigating the meter issues. Now, if you've had an experience with smart meters you'd like to share, or another story we should investigate, go to cbs5.com/investigates and send me an email. We'll be interested to hear about it. Dana, we'll keep watching this for you.
I'll be looking at my bill. Thank you, Anna.
It's like, and Trent is trying to call me, so I'm going to flip him the hangout invite. I just messaged him with it. I said, can't answer because we are in a hangout. Click the link. He said, okay, I'll talk later. Or... He says, I'm inland, down under, just got Wi-Fi. Okay. Well... And he's saying He's got something to do in a few hours, and it's 7 a.m. over there in Aussie land. And he's just saying hi. And so on. Anyway, moving on. Okay. Next piece of interesting information.
Some East Bay neighbors are really turning up the heat on PG&E. People who live in and around 22nd Avenue in Oakland are declaring their neighborhood a no smart meter zone. Linda Yee on how they're planning to defy the powerful utility. Linda.
Well, Dana, these signs tell their story. They are taking a stand against PG&E. The people in this neighborhood say, don't you dare remove these old meters for those new smart ones, even if it means their power could get cut off. This is a neighborhood rebelling, some homeowners putting PG&E on notice. Keep those smart meters away.
Heard all sorts of horror stories about how the meters have been functioning improperly and at times reporting energy usage in excess of the actual amount. Mm-hmm. And so I don't quite understand why they're being installed at the rate of...
Hold on a minute, I got a knock at my door. I'm live on the air. What's up, Kate?
I need to talk to you. Mom and Sandy and Dad are going to the store, and I probably want something, and I don't want to go. Can you stay here and watch me?
Well, I'm live on the air right now on the internet, so if you don't mind coming up here, then yes.
Yeah. I'll be right back, okay?
Okay.
Until they leave. Because if they leave, I'll come up.
Okay. Well, it's okay if you want to come up here.
It's okay.
But I'm live on the air right now, so I can't go down there.
It's okay.
So everything you're saying, the world is listening. They can hear you. Say hi, Katie.
Hi.
Hey, Rich, say hi.
Hello.
So we're talking to people online. So come up when you're ready.
All right.
Okay. Love you. She's cute. That was Katie. So, moving on.
A day, despite the fact that there are some known difficulties.
Consumer Group Utility Reform Network, or TURN, is helping Oakland's Manzanita neighborhood become a smart meter-free zone.
I think that there are more problems with the meter than PG&E is admitting to. I think that there's some questions about the accuracy of the meter. I know that there was supposedly an independent commission that was looking into the entire meter situation.
The new smart meter sends a customer's power usage to PG&E through a wireless transmitter. CBS 5 Investigates has talked to numerous customers who have complained about bills suddenly doubling. PG&E recently admitted to problems with over 40,000 smart meters. Customers say the utility should just stop installing the meters for now.
Why not allow a third party to examine the devices and see what the problems are, whether it's in the technology or the installation?
At the time that this investigation comes out with their findings, then I'll reevaluate the whole smart meter situation to determine whether or not I think it's worth getting into.
And there are some families who say they're just worried the smart meters may be unsafe.
The radiation from them is not something that we have... We don't do any Wi-Fi or any, we don't even do fast track, you know. we don't really want to have an emitting meter.
The PUC rules do allow the utility to cut off power if they have to, if there is a customer that doesn't cooperate. However, PG&E has not done that in any of the cases of these smart meter issues, but Dana, they say they really would prefer customers call them if they have any questions about this technology.
Yeah, that's a good place to start. All right, Linda Yee in Oakland, thank you.
Okay, and Kristen is messaging me here. I'll go ahead and forward her that link. Shove that. There you go. That's okay, so let's see, where were we? Going back up here. Okay, there's the one about Oakland. Oh, utility break-in. This one was funny. When I watched this, I was like, wow.
I was hearing this banging on the basement door, which is the door that leads into the hydrometers that are in here. So I leave my bed and I come down here and I sit right here on the step and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna film this.
Sorry. I'm just putting in your meters. Your power's gonna be up for about 20, well, when I find the meters. Oh, they're down here, right?
I'll show you the door. I'd heard her banging, but I didn't know that she actually kicked the door in until she left. Because when she left, I came here and I found this on the ground. I was like, wow, she actually kicked the door in. We since repaired the door. And we put these, do not install a smart meter sign on her door.
As part of the 2009 U.S. bailout, $3.4 billion was funneled into a national smart grid stimulus, later increased to $11 billion. This created a scenario where utilities were given a massive financial incentive to go along with the program.
They're being found in pilot programs now, smart grids are, to really save no energy whatsoever.
So who benefits?
I got a bill in December for $1,107. There's got to be a mistake.
No mistake, says PG&E. After reviewing their accounts, the company says their meters were working correctly, just like those of the 1,500 other Californians who complained. Consumer advocate Mindy Spatz says that still doesn't explain something else.
Customers with the smart meters claim that their energy usage has inexplicably risen since the meters were put in.
So in other words, it makes it look like all of a sudden they're using twice as much energy as they used to use.
Exactly.
We start the week with an explosive investigation into the massive mistakes being made with power bills. Serious flaws affecting every electricity user with a smart meter have been uncovered. And when this whistleblower told his power company what he'd found, they offered to pay him off. This exclusive investigation by James Thomas has sparked calls for a national inquiry.
She actually broke down the fucking door. I was like, wow. Like, what the hell?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry. Was this your private property? Oh, gee.
Oh, did I just vandalize? My bad.
Yeah.
But since I work for the electric company, I don't get to be arrested or sued. What a crock.
Yeah, no kidding. I would have replaced that door with a kick-resistant door, so the next time somebody tried that, even with the signs, they'd break their leg trying to kick that open. And then if they tried to sue me over it, I'd go, no, you were the one kicking my door in. you wouldn't have broken your leg if you hadn't been trying to kick my door in and unconstitutionally coming on my property.
Yeah, no kidding. RT even chimed in on the issue here, as you would imagine they always do.
Yeah.
Do you know what kind of meter you have in your home? No, this isn't just my nerdy curiosity. This is actually something that you should be considering. Over recent years, there's been a huge push by energy companies working in conjunction with the government to install smart meters. What's a smart meter? Well, it's an electric meter that energy corporations allege will streamline how power consumption is monitored in your home. Check it out.
I'm Bob from Woodland, and this is my power. I used to watch my bill only once a month when it came in, and it got so high I thought I was powering the streetlight out front. Then I got the smart meter. They have a whole lot of little graphs that tell you on an hourly basis how much energy you're using. I show that to the family. I said, you see this spike? That means a lot of money, so let's bring that spike down. Our family now is trained. We're not using them. Pull the plugs. That's why in my house, I'm known as the energy cop.
Energy cop, huh? Sounds terrifying. And actually not too far off from reality. Now get this. Power companies have been sending people to homes across the country to switch out the old analog meters for these brand new, all-digital smart meters. Remember that little guy that used to come to your house to measure energy usage? They'd write it down on a little notepad and then send you a bill at the end of the month. Well, that little guy is out of a job. He's been replaced with smart meters equipped with RF chips, technology that allows power companies to monitor these devices without actually ever coming to your home. So just how smart are they? Well, not only do they rapidly record information by the hour, but they can determine just what type of energy you're using. Think about that for 1 second. It may not seem like too much intrusion, but consider this. Energy corporations will have precise data on your daily routines. When you wash your clothes, when you watch TV, when you leave your home, and when you come back. And if the notion that they know what you're doing and when you're doing it isn't disturbing enough, it's worse. Because these devices are also capable of controlling, regulating, and even rationing your energy use. Take this for example. You're running your AC during those hot summer months, and the power company decides that you're using just a little too much power. Well, they can take it upon themselves to lower it, regardless of if you're willing to pay more for that extra usage. Another point to consider is what these companies can do with this information. Once they share it with law enforcement, it can, and believe me, it will be used against you. Cops will be able to know just what you're doing at all times in the privacy of your own home. Hey, who needs a telescreen when you have a smart meter? Secondly, these corporations can sell this information about our daily lives for data mining and advertising. It's disturbing on so many levels. Yet, these little surveillance units are being implemented across the country without the public's consent, and in many cases without their knowledge that they're even being installed. And it's leading to an array of problems. Check it out.
This is a smart meter. It uses electromagnetic frequency to send DTE information about power use. This gets rid of the need for meter readers and notifies the power company about outages. But some say such meters are making them sick.
I couldn't understand why I was feeling so foolish.
First, a warning.
And so I came back and tried to put my hand in front of him like this.
Then a scuffle.
And he just kept pushing me away and pushing me away. And
what was the guy after?
This meter.
Yep, an electric meter. He wanted to replace it with a new one like this, a so-called smart meter. Problem was, Thelma Tarmina wanted to keep her old one. She had put up warning signs to leave it alone. But the worker wouldn't listen, so Tarmina grabbed her gun. Her lights are out. Her electric meter has stopped spinning. But this is not due to a storm or for failing to pay her bill. It's because this self-employed photographer has refused to allow a new smart meter in her home. Result, a lineman pulled up and disconnected her from the grid.
Yes, companies are actually threatening to shut off your power if you refuse to allow a smart meter to be installed in your home. Look, guys, it may seem like you don't have a choice in this, but these meters are not mandatory yet. You don't have to subject yourself to unknown health risks or increased utility costs. You most certainly don't have to give up your privacy to private corporations. What you have to do is be bold enough to say no.
Yeah, exactly. And as we've seen, there are ways to do that without getting arrested, and you don't have to pull a gun.
Mm-hmm. As I was discussing earlier, that was the exact example I was using, and synchronistically you bring a video that has that example in it, you know, backs up my point. Yeah, you definitely don't, if it gets to the point where you're having to pull a gun on somebody who's doing something like that, that's when it gets to the point where it's like the police state is like fully being ruled out. If they're having to bring in SWAT agents to, you know, enforce these guys putting those things on against your will, you know it's too late. But the good news is they couldn't get away with that if they wanted to, because they don't have enough resources, number one. And number two, the first person they tried that to, it would go viral and everybody would know about it, and there would be a bunch of politicians getting tracked down and dealt with.
Yeah, I mean, people are so ultra paranoid about the government, but they forget that to do anything against you, it takes money and resources and manpower. And so if there's a lot of people saying no to something, you got to figure what the ratio of the people saying no is to their actual power of enforcement. Can 3,000 cops arrest a million people at once? Of course not. And, you know, there are people like certain unnamed, unmentioned people I won't bring up, but I'll just bring up the circumstance because it's a common circumstance. People that are terrified that, oh, you better not disagree with the government on the internet, otherwise within days the men in black suits will be busting down your door and da-da-da. It's like, well, that would have been true if maybe this was done in like 1998 or something, when the internet was kind of fledgling and most people weren't on it. But there are so many people that, you know, especially with this current, you know, Wall Street puppet administration that both Democrats and Republicans alike are extremely mad at, you know, so many people just on the hour even going so far as to say, hey, in my opinion, I think Obama should be arrested and brought before a military tribunal, charged with treason and crimes against humanity, and then publicly executed. There are so many people who say that sort of stuff all the time, and nobody's had men in dark suits frickin' bust down their door and take them away. You know, it's just, you have to be at least halfway frickin' important for them to bother. Because there's just so many people that are disgruntled and speaking out, you know, tens of millions of people. There's just not enough manpower. The government does not have the manpower to track down every single person saying poopy doopy doo, I don't like this, and busting down their door and dragging them out to do whatever with them. There's just not enough manpower for that. So people get ultra paranoid about the government because they think it's still like, you know, 1995 or something, when, you know, most people didn't know anything that was going on and that, you know, there were very few people speaking out. No, sorry, but, you know, this is like 20 years down the line. People need to kind of adjust their clocks and calendars and realize that it's not 20 years ago. They need to kind of wake up and smell the 21st century and realize that everybody and their mothers on frickin' social networking speaking their opinion every second of every day, and there's just not enough personnel to go, you know, bust down everybody's door, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'd love to stay around and chat, but I need to get to work, and I won't be back for this call. This hangout will definitely be over by the time I return, so you're going to have to continue the rest of it without my participation, so I will get back as soon as I can.
All right, you can always catch up on things later. I'm just gonna roll out a few more pieces of, you know, video information here and then close it out if nobody else chimes in to participate.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure Kristen's watching. If she wants to, you know, come on in on the invite, then, you know, she can if she wants. It's just going to be me here for now, rolling through these videos, or unless, you know, one of the other people I invited pops in or whatever. I don't know what's going to go on, but I'll catch you later, Rich. And as far as everybody else watching this, I'm going to share a little more data, and then if nobody else pops in to say anything or whatever, I'll just kind of give final thoughts and close it down after that.
Okay, sounds good. I will see you later, Dave, and I hope everybody has a good morning, evening, afternoon, day, wherever you are on the world, wherever you're watching this, and I will see you all later.
Yep, catch you later. Okay, so Rich left. Now I'm going to, let's see here. Yeah, I think it was this video. The dark side of smart meters. I think that's the one that I was thinking about that I wanted to share with you guys. It's not super short, but it's not super long either. And if it's the one I'm thinking of, this guy gives a pretty good presentation. So hopefully you find this to be informative.
So those of you who have cell phones, it would be great if you extinguish them. Don't just turn them off, but turn them all the way off. We have electromagnetically sensitive people in the audience, and they and I would appreciate it. First of all, thanks everyone for coming out. And the topic of the day is the dark side of smart meters, and primarily to tell you what PG&E doesn't. I am Rob States, briefly three MS degrees, not in microwave technology. One would wonder why listen to me. So I tend to list relevant work experiences when I'm giving a talk. For about 2 years, I consulted for Microsource that makes microwave synthesizers up in Santa Rosa. And I was doing, you know, basically circuit troubleshooting for those guys. I've designed several mainstream power generating pieces of equipment in the grid, and I'm the planet's leading expert on pulsed impingement. I sold a job to the Department of Energy, and this technology is capable of reducing the planet's energy consumption by about 0.75%. That's one invention, 0.75% reduction. It basically doubles the efficiency of drying paper. So the point being that I have expertise both in the microwave side and in the power generation side. So this is kind of the introduction for the afternoon. So the idea is to basically outline what is a smart meter, and then the health impacts, which are like drive you nuts, and the privacy impact, which will double drive you nuts. And the idea is to create an action plan, which, since I'm an engineer, I don't have the action plan, but we have Larry Bragman here who does have an action plan. So let's describe what we're talking about here, which is the power grid. And during a typical day, there is lots of power consumption during the middle of the day, and there isn't very much in the middle of the night. And so the primary reason for having smart meters is to move some of this demand over to there. So basically, a smart meter is therefore responsible for zero reduction in usage. Zero reduction. It is primarily a device that moves power from one place to another. Unlike, for example, superconducting high tension lines, okay? Those would be responsible for a 30% increase in total efficiency and a total reduction in usage of power, usage of fuel to generate the power. Boy, am I not doing a good job here. But these meters of themselves are responsible for no reduction in the consumption of electricity. The customer's behavior is responsible, and on a good day, PG&E cites the number 4 to 12%, okay? So if you think of a typical $100 a month power bill, that's like 40 bucks a year. I mean, how much customer sort of activity are you gonna get out of that fairly small amount of money. So that factors into, well, I'll get back to that. This is off of Silver Spring's website that basically describes the system. And as you can see, it's very simple. Any straightforward questions for that? Let me give you the quick tour de force. Over here is your house. And here is a smart meter that's connected to your house. And eventually, this smart meter then talks to PG&E, which is over here somewhere. But what it also does is it talks to the neighbor's meter, and that to the neighbor's meter, and that to the neighbor. And what we're showing here is that this is what's called net topology. That means your meter has to send about 700 numbers a day to PG&E so that they know time of day use for your house. Okay, that only takes 45 seconds. But it may not be talking directly to a cell tower. It may be talking, which is this thing right here, it may not be in direct line of sight to a cell tower. So it will talk to its neighboring smart meter. That neighboring smart meter will talk to another neighboring smart meter. And so the duty cycle the PG&E sites is for this meter talking, let's say this meter talking directly to a cell tower. But what they are leaving out of the details are this meter be collecting data from tens to dozens to hundreds of other meters. In fact, the duty cycle of this thing could be nearly continuous. So it is an unknown factor. Now, I'm in the civil engineering fire life safety business, where we are designing civil engineering structures for safety of individuals. And in those structures, we are overwhelmingly conservative. We make the most severe assumptions to preserve human life. In this system, that says the thing is on most of the time, and that violates some of the major tenets of how these systems have been sold by PG&E and how they have been approved by the FCC. So basically, this baby gives power to your system, to your house, and it sits there and thinks about the power and then sends its thoughts back. And this smart meter also has a second channel of communication where it talks directly to what are called smart-enabled appliances inside of your house. And currently there are none or virtually few smart appliances, but the CPUC wants to change that. This is the radiation pattern from a typical smart meter. They have what is called a dipole antenna, and it radiates radially. So if the antenna is like this, it radiates out this way and doesn't radiate very much out this way. And this is required so that it can both talk to a cell tower, which may be slightly above it, but at a shallow angle, or to a neighboring smart meter, which would be a lateral communication. But what is in the lateral distance between this meter and the next smart meter? That's people, that's houses. That the majority of the radiation that comes off of this is not for communication. It's wasted radiation that goes to individuals and structures in the general vicinity. Cell phones use this style of antenna exclusively, and part of it goes directly into your head, which is a major concern. If you read the fine print on an iPhone, it says, always use the iPhone 5/8 of an inch away from your head. That means you are told in the fine print 6-point type in the subparagraph of some appendix to hold the thing with an air gap between your head, because when it is touching your head, this radiation is actually above the FCC limit. This is strictly optional. These antenna could be designed as high gain transmitters, and all it would mean is you either put it on this side of your head where the cell tower is this way, or this side of your head where the cell tower is that way, and you could drop the energy consumption, or let's say the energy wasted to your head by a factor of 1,000. It would be fairly easy to design. But in 1996, the Telecommunications Act relieved them of any local requirements to get the position of the cell towers approved. So they can put a cell tower anywhere they want. And the writer in 1998 resolved them of any liability. So they are in a position of not requiring to consider your health when they're either designing the system or designing the phones. And more convenience is the sales feature, and that is what's been driving this industry, is more convenience. A smart meter typically goes on the outside of your house, and so there it is located. But what's directly on the other side of this? That's the interior of your house. So because we know that this is a laterally transmitting device, on the other side, this is being laterally transmitted through the wall. So if you're sleeping over here, you're getting radiation from this meter you know, 8 hours a day. If this is your office, you know, a high occupancy area, the exposure could be substantial. So let's discuss the health ramifications of this piece of equipment. We are fairly familiar with ionizing radiation, which say an X-ray hits your cell inside of the cell's nucleus, it breaks a DNA molecule, and from then on, the children of this cell have a defective DNA, which turns on a RAS gene or some other naughty thing, and this cell then replicates and becomes a tumor. So this is a well-known, well-understood action path, but this is like an X-ray or a cosmic ray. It is an extremely high-energy piece of radiation, and cell phones and smart meters put out much lower frequencies, typically 900 megahertz. And so we are assured by some scientists that ionizing radiation is required for this. But in fact, non-ionizing radiation disrupts van der Waals bonds, and that is the major bond during creation of proteins and replication of DNA. And you may think of a covalent bond as the rubber on the bottom of your shoe. If you want to get the rubber off, you have to scrape it or you have to cut it. It's very ruggedly bonded to your shoe. But a van der Waals bond is like the mud that's on the bottom of your shoe. It's fairly easy to scrape off. If you rinse it off, it comes off easily. That's a low energy bond. And you have much lower frequencies that can disrupt these. You are producing roughly 3,000 miles of DNA per day. You're making about 20 billion new cells. Each one has got about 3 feet. You figured out it's like 3,000 miles. You're zipping this stuff out like crazy. And every time there's a disruption from RF radiation, you are running the risk of creating an error either in DNA transcription or in the creation of a protein. This fuzzy slide is looking at an individual who is sensitive to microwave radiation. In this case, the person is talking on a 900 megahertz handheld phone. That means it's not even a cell phone. It's a phone that only talks to a base station that's a few feet away, and it's convenient so that you don't have a wire. This is a normal person, and when they talk on this 900 megahertz phone, there is virtually no change in their physiological condition. But this person, their heart rate goes from roughly 68 up to 122, and the heart rate becomes irregular. And as soon as you turn the phone off, they return to normal sinus rhythm. This is one of many sensitivity issues with microwave radiation. This is a normal person. This is a sensitive person. How many sensitive people are there in a general population? And this this Swedish study indicates that there's roughly 3% of the population that is severely sensitive to microwave radiation. And you put smart meters in a residential area, and these people either have to move or they have to heavily shield their houses. 35% of the population is moderately sensitive. So we are in a gray area here where the impact on property values and the impact on the population in general is relatively significant. This is a study done in Spain where directly underneath a cell tower, they are mapping out as a function of distance, and this is 300 meters, so that's like an eighth of a mile, something like that, at 1,000 feet, from close to that far away from a cell tower, the various psychological and physical symptoms that people experience. And right underneath the cell tower, we're looking at 80%, 70%+ of the people experience fatigue, drowsiness, headaches, discomfort feelings, depression. So even the existing cell towers are generating significant problems, health problems for people nearby. This is a quick example of what we're dealing with in the case of an industry that's generating $500 billion worth of market revenue a year. This is a Reuters news service, October 13th, 2009, just last year. And they were reporting on a South Korean study that studied the links between mobile phones and tumors. And at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the Reuters news feed said, high quality studies often show potential cancer link. Underneath that, the second bullet said, industry funded studies most likely to show no link. Then you read the data that this study verifies these conclusions. At 6 o'clock, only 2 hours later, these two bullets were compressed into a single bullet and changed to read, it found no significant association between the risk of tumors and overall use of mobile phones, including cellular and portable phones. Basically, 180-degree change, and as you can see, only 2 hours later, this is the power of the cell phone industry. We see this time and again in the cell phone industry, in the smart meter industry, that we're seeing a lot more industry spin than we are hard science. This is the most complicated slide that I've placed today, and it is the most important. So allow me to dissect this, give you the importance of what this is. Over here is a map of San Francisco. The peninsula is on the bottom, Golden Gate Bridge is on the top, and as you can see, there is a plus, okay? The middle of that plus is the Sutro Tower. You can see the Sutro Tower up on the top. That thing pumps out the better part of 20 megawatts of radiated energy into the environment. It radiates AM radio, FM radio, and television. From the period 1973 to 1988, it was the primary source of RF radiation to everyone on that peninsula. What's good about that? A, I don't want to live there, but B, it is a fabulous test tube. You know the exact dose based on where people live. There are 123 people in this study, children under the age of 21, that have contracted either leukemia, lymphoma, or glioma, basically the most common cancers of children under the age of 21. And these little stars indicate where they lived. And they are pretty much all over the all over the peninsula. Okay, they are not concentrated underneath the Sutro Tower. They are fairly evenly distributed all over. Okay, and this is a plot of the radiation they received from the Sutro Tower and those children's prevalency compared to the general population of these cancers. And we see that if you're directly under the Sutro Tower, you have an 18-fold chance of getting childhood leukemia. Not 18%, 18-fold. An 18,000% increase in the prevalency of cancer directly underneath the Sutro Tower. As you go away from the Sutro Tower up to the coast, which is 5 kilometers away, you are still at four times a four-fold increase in the prevalency of childhood leukemia. This gorgeous correlation persists for all four of the diseases studied. In other words, this is a disease of RF radiation. There are no other cofactors. It doesn't matter what your genetic background is. It doesn't matter your socioeconomic position. It doesn't matter toxins that you're exposed to. What matters is where you live on the peninsula and the amount of RF radiation that you receive. This is a plot of the RF radiation as you go from the Sutro Tower out. It is denominated in microwatts per square centimeter, which is sort of an industry standard. It's one of the power factor standards. So this is the number directly underneath the Sutro Tower that corresponds to this amplification. And out here at the edge of the peninsula, we are down in this range of, say, 0.1 to 1 microwatts per square centimeter. Okay. As we move over to this side of the plot, I have given you what the radiative power is of a typical smart meter at 1 foot, at 3 feet, at 30 feet, and at 92 feet. And what I'm asserting is I do not want to be this close to a smart meter. That is in this highly accelerated area where I'm increasing, in this case, childhood leukemia, but by implication, it is biologically active for other diseases. This is the only one that was studied in this study.
Hold on a minute, folks. I need to answer the phone. Yeah, what's up? Okay, thanks. I'm in the middle of broadcasting right now. I'm live. All right, bye. Sorry about that, folks. We will resume.
But what it says is this is a canary in the coal mine, and we should stay away from this level of radiation. When you were 3 feet away, you were here. 30 feet away, you were there. But at 92 feet, you are under, this is a logarithmic plot. So I don't know if you're safe, but this is like an area where it might be safe, or at least safer. So I decided to plot these contours in my neighborhood. Here's my house, from Google, you know, above. And this is the danger zone. That is a 92-foot radius circle. And my meter is here, and the smart meter is going to radiate my living room. It's going to radiate one of the bedrooms. And this is fairly dangerous. I would point out that this level of radiation is incident on the roofs of the houses in question. Okay, this is attenuated when it goes inside the house where the children spend most of their time. So the actual risk profile is down here somewhere. So when I plot this in my neighborhood, it is actually much worse out here. And this is an accurate portrayal of what conditions are like inside my house. That is, this is an inside the house contour. This is a risk factor. This is where my neighbor's meter is. And likewise, there's a bedroom affected. And this is my second neighbor. This is a daycare center. Their meter is in the playground of the daycare center. Children will be walking within inches of the smart meter. First of all, PG&E has done nothing to ameliorate this. These have been installed down in LA, and they have not informed citizens who have bedrooms that are near the radiation source, nor daycares or other child-populated areas like schools that have excess. And again, this is a much worse exposure contour than is given here, because these risks are inside the house, and these risks are direct radiation through the air, significantly higher. So the first point I'd like to make is this: the safety of these devices is not at all verified by the data. And if you take a group of lab rats and you give them an L50 dose of a toxin, let's say lead or mercury, that is a dose that kills half of the population. So if you give half of that dose to you get more survivors, okay? But if you take half of the L10 dose for lead and half of the L10 dose for mercury, and you give that to the rats, they all die. What I'm making a point is that the risk factors to human beings and to health is not linear. You can't make an assumption of half is twice as good as whatever. And so in the case of this radiation, it is pulsed radiation, meaning that it's on briefly and then it's off. It's on briefly and it's off. And you do not have the ability, when there's continuous, like with the Sutro Tower, which is continuous radiation, your body doesn't have a chance to sort of cope with it. Okay? It is on, it is off. And it could be that this form of radiation is vastly more damaging to human health. We don't know. It is totally unknown risk. The FCC says that 600 microwatts per square centimeter is an allowable continuous radiation. 600 microwatts per square centimeter. That is this line on this curve. As we can see, this is vastly in excess of the measured dose level at a 18-fold increase in childhood leukemia. This level has been based on studies done in the mid-1980s. We are much smarter now. And this study was published in 2002, I believe, 2002, which means the PG&E had every opportunity to be aware of this study before they configured their system. They could have put high gain antennas on and dropped this by a factor of 1,000, and they did not. They could have done transmission of signals on the power wiring. They could have done optical wiring, and they have done none of that. They have taken a technology path that exposes us to, according to this study, significant risk. Here is a typical smart meter that's installed on a wall. And this is a graph that was measured on the pillow of a person who was sleeping on this side. The pillow. This means that person is exposed to radiation 8 hours every night when they are sleeping. And we measured 0.05 microwatts per square centimeter, well above the safety level. In Italy, their smart grid is powered by a system that uses no radiation. It is technologically possible. If you talk to PG&E, they say, no, it is not possible. As George alluded to early on, when I found out about the smart meter, I got a message in the mail that said we're about to put one of those babies in, and I pretty much jumped out of my skin. I did some minor research, and I knew right off the bat these things were trouble on a stick. I called to opt out, and they said, you're in a lot of hurt. We're not opting anybody out. And so I started sending emails to my mayor, and I said, we need to have a town council meeting. I want to bring this up. And we agreed that I would give a 15-minute presentation that's a condensed version of this that gives them some of these findings. I'm a registered PE in the state of California. I have the ability to talk about this subject. When the meeting came up, PG&E was on the podium for 45 minutes giving their spin, and I was denied the ability to present this information to them. So what you're seeing is suppressed information. 2 days before that meeting, PG&E, well, when I, unbeknownst to me, the mayor was forwarding all of my emails to her, to PG&E. PG&E requested my presence at a meeting. They gave me the spin. I said, you're way above these leukemia levels. Their spin was, that's only one study. We use the FCC. They look at all studies. We use the standards from the UN. They look at all studies. And they, as we'll hear from Mary Beth later on, there is significant insincerity in how the industry uses this. Just recently, the Los Angeles Unified School District said that 1994 law that gives the local governments no control over cell phone towers, they want that repealed. They see this impacting the health of their children. The European Parliament has recently voted in favor of being more precautions to human health than is currently being done. France has banned cell phones in primary schools. They can only text. And the federal government has officially acknowledged that electronic hypersensitivity is a disability. That means municipalities are on the hook to ameliorate effects of affected people. This, I believe, is the whole reason PG&E came to see me, the privacy issue. Here we have a smart meter that is monitoring the power going to your house, and here are some activities that might be occurring in the house. And what I've shown here is a $3.24 DSP chip. DSP stands for Digital Signal Processing. This is something that I learned at MIT. And for the better part of 9 years, I worked for Ingersoll Rand, and I designed digital signal filtering for industrial control systems. And what I mean by that is when you are putting power to a motor in an industrial process, by looking at the frequency characteristics of that motor, you can determine the health of the process. It's a great way to not have to put a probe inside of the process. All you have to do is watch the motor and infer what the process is doing. If I have a $3 chip inside of this, I can do a wealth of interesting things. For example, when you turn on a hair dryer, that's a series wound motor that has a 1800 watt heater attached to it. The signal for that is totally easy to spot. If I were to look at that in the Fourier transform domain, I could infer that at 5 o'clock in the morning or so, you turned on a dryer for 10 minutes, 8 minutes, 4 minutes, some number. When you turn on the fan in your bathroom, that is a fractional horsepower induction motor with a shaded pole start. Okay, again, fairly easy to spot. And the smart meter could therefore say, gee, at about 6:02 in the morning or 3 in the morning or whenever, you turned on the fan in your bathroom. Or here's a woman enjoying a vibrator. That is a DC motor with a variable speed drive and possibly a switching power supply, okay? This is easily discernible, okay, from these other appliances. This woman turned it on for 20 minutes at 9 p.m. at night, okay? This meter is fully capable of keeping all of this information in its memory. PG&E hasn't told us whether they're doing this or not, but what they have told us is the software inside of a smart meter is proprietary. That means we don't get to know it. Thank you so much. I doubt if that's a coincidence. A.C. Nielsen collaborated with MIT in 1992, and they said, barcodes are great. That tells us what you are. Customer cards are great. They tell us who bought the stuff. But what they also said was, what is missing in our marketing strategy is when, where, and how usage. And they were presenting this to MIT saying, this is a problem. We do not know when, where, and how our products are being bought, how they're being used. If the smart meter supplies this information, I assert that this has an extraordinary amount of marketing value. This isn't a trivial bit of information that we can discount. There are people with a lot of money who want to know this. And PG&E is asserting, well, we're not doing it. But by the way, all the stuff that goes on inside of the meter is top secret. Here is, and if you think that's bad, they're just getting warmed up. Here is graphics from the industry itself talking about this link inside of the house. Smart meters talk directly to smart-enabled devices. It's like a Bluetooth, okay? And the CPUC has already committed to mandating that all appliances sold in California are smart-enabled, which means they will intelligently talk to your smart meter over what is something like a Bluetooth link. So that means when you're in the, here they are enjoying their smart meter in the entertainment room, it will be telling us devices that are on, what they're doing. Here's mom and daughter in the kitchen. Here they are preparing a healthy snack. And here we have where they're enjoying their smart meter in the bedroom. This is right out of their literature. Bold faced. They're telling us this is the information that this meter will be privy to, far more detailed information than it is inferring from its own digital signal processing capabilities. We do not have a block diagram of that meter. We don't have the software that's used, and they are only alluding to the data that is being collected. In the meeting that I had with him, they described the data that they were collecting, but they did not allude to the fact that because this is a digital signal processing device, it can infer a great deal more. in addition to that data stream, which is currently uncontrolled, they're not talking about it. There's no law against them taking it based on how they're qualifying these devices legally. And in addition to that gaping hole in security, UC Berkeley professors agree that the security they're using just on the devices as they're currently described by PG&E, the security is insufficient. Which means the data that they're collecting is like easy to hack and easy to broadcast to the rest of the world. The Fourth Amendment to the Constitution says the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, and papers shall not be abridged. This thing is directly looking at the interior of your house if it collects this sort of information. This I have not given permission to PG&E to do, as no one in this room has, because they have not even asked for that permission. They are assuming that this meter is identical to the meter that they currently have a utility easement for. Okay, but the current meter, it sits on the side of the house, and I could care less if somebody walks up and looks at the numbers. Go ahead, look at my neighbors, have a blast. But I do not want this thing giving a diary of the internal activities in my home to the highest bidder. I'm in a court suit with my health insurance provider saying, listen here, you were supposed to cover my kidney disease, what's wrong? They stand in court and say, Your Honor, look at this information showing that this person was up in the middle of the night for months and months before they ever contracted with us for health insurance. They didn't disclose this to us. They're being ingenuine. And you can imagine the ramifications of this if this is being sold to the highest bidder. The CPUC's charter indicates that they are dedicated to having safe and reliable equipment. I doubt if that is supported by how this, by the preceding. TURN, the Utility Reform Network, agrees when they are basically providing a contrary opinion to the release of the smart meter equipment. Not due to that. They said that PG&E's business case for the analysis is overly optimistic. Like, you're going to get $40 a year. Are you going to do much for that? That's basically dinner and a movie. The demand response forecast is overly optimistic. They say meter reading could be accomplished with a less comprehensive system. Enough said. The action plan, I don't have one. Clearly, health is a problem. Clearly, privacy is a problem. But health is governed by two federal acts that are fairly onerous. Tobacco was legal for decades before we finally started turning the tide. Reducing how much advertising they could do, requiring packaging labeling. We are in the same situation with electromagnetic sensitivity, that it's going to be a good 20 years before the data is in, before it's published in peer-reviewed journals. We've already got data that says there are health impacts, but the level of proof that's required by federal agencies, that's going to take longer to develop. So we're in a case of buyer beware.
Okay. So I don't really think that this is any kind of a leap of logic here. Nothing crazy or conspiracy theory or anything like that. Back in the 50s, they said, hey, smoking's good for you. Doctors even prescribed it as a method of reducing stress. And it's like, oh, maybe not so much. And that took a while. McDonald's used to actually be so bold as to claim that their food was healthy and nutritious and good for you. And we ended up finding out that was quite the opposite, so on and so forth. So the idea of big, huge corporations being extremely shady, this is not any sort of leap of logic or conspiracy theory. This is something that's been ongoing. This is very common. There's no way to count how many complaints, not only over the decades, but even in recent times, just on the internet, people bitching about how they got screwed by this corporation or screwed by that corporation, going on a big rant about it, and lawsuits with corporations and so on and so forth. So, this is not a leap of logic here. I'm not talking about reptilian aliens from Mars infesting people's rectums and hibernating in there waiting for a global takeover of whatever. I'm not talking about little green Ben or beam me up Scotty or things that are completely unfucking believable. I'm just talking about shady corporations doing shady shit. I would hope that that concept, at least at this point, is pretty common to most people, that most people aren't going to look at that and go, oh my God, he's a conspiracy nut. Corporations are wholesome and sent by God to protect us and love us. They could never do anything wrong. Hopefully nobody's really actually sitting there thinking that. Hopefully people realize that governments are controlled by Wall Street. Hopefully people understand a little concept called lobbying. Hopefully people understand about corruption. Hopefully at this point in 2015 that these topics are not just oh so controversial and unbelievable. Hopefully at this point this is kind of like, an everyday no-brainer, the grass is green, the sky is blue, sort of an idea. Hopefully I'm not, being received by too many people as like, oh my God, that guy's like way out there, I mean, there's going to be some whose heads are stuck in the 1950s that'll just never wake up and okay, fine, whatever. But for the majority of people, I think we're awake enough to put it together, I think, one would hope. The majority of people might not be fully awake to the finer points of the corruption, but at least the basic idea that they're shady fucking people with a lot of money who take that money and do shady shit, and they're psychopaths and sociopaths and they're greedy and they don't give a fuck who they screw to, further empower themselves financially and, monetarily and whatever. So hopefully this isn't some, massive leap of logic that people have just such difficulty wrapping their heads around. Now, I'm not suggesting that anyone be afraid or be in fear or anything like that. Panic is like drunk driving. I'm not suggesting that to anybody. That's completely neurotic and destructive, and it doesn't help the situation. It doesn't help you. It doesn't help anybody. So I'm not suggesting that anybody be afraid of these smart meters or afraid of the corporations or afraid of the police station or afraid of anything. That's not going to do anything for you. But I would like to suggest that people be calm and clear-minded and do their research and become as informed as possible. And, to do what you can to first and foremost raise awareness. I mean, hey, jump on YouTube, make some videos, monetize them, get paid for doing that, earn a few bucks waking people up, helping humanity. Cool, you know? That's not asking, you know, you to have your teeth pulled without anesthetic and then shove, you know, bluntly into the tip hole of your penis or something. You know, it's not, I'm not asking anybody to undergo excruciating torture. I'm making a very simple suggestion, you know. So, no big deal there. I don't think I'm being unreasonable. That's a very simple way to spread the word about this or about any issue. You know, go ahead and do that. You might be surprised what kind of a difference you make. If, like I said earlier, if only 10 people ever watch any one video you make, but then those 10 people take that information and inspire 10 other people, who then each inspire 10 others, and so on and so forth. You know, power in numbers begins at the individual level. If everybody's sitting there going, I expect everybody else to do it, nobody does it, nothing gets done. But if one person starts to do it, it's like pushing the domino. It's a chain reaction. It starts having an effect. Everybody's always sitting there like, man, I wish somebody would really do something about that. It'd be nice if somebody did something. Well, you're somebody. Everybody is somebody. So, you know, people don't take that into consideration. You know, instead of sitting around waiting for everybody else to do something about it, why don't you do something? That's what Kennedy meant when he said, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. He meant ask yourself, like, what are my capabilities? You know, what can I do? What am I capable of? What can I take the initiative and use my imagination and my intelligence and put forth of my own ability to, you know, operate in this freaking world? What can I do to be a benefit, to be a service, you know, to myself, to my country, to my fellow human beings? What can I do? You know, really sit there and ponder that for a second. That's what Kennedy was suggesting. So this is not a new idea. You know, Kennedy got up and said the same thing. This is not a new idea at all. So, you know, it's real simple. You know, you don't have to put the weight of the world on your shoulders, drive yourself neurotic, crazy. Just do what you can do. Maybe have a little bit of fun doing it too. I mean, hey, making a YouTube video is fun, right? And these days with the Google Hangout broadcast on air feature, you know, it doesn't require any specialized equipment. Shit, a cell phone and a YouTube channel are the minimum requirements at that point, or a laptop and a YouTube channel or whatever, wireless or non-wireless, pick your device, whatever floats your boat. The minimum requirements are pretty simple. And just, you know, get up there and have, you know, have that conversation, put your thoughts out there. I know it's tempting to think, well, I'm just nobody, you know, like, who's going to care about what I think and blah, 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 blah. But what do you think I am? I'm just a regular person, just a human being with opinions and a big fucking mouth and a stubborn son of a bitch who goes and rambles on about his opinions. So, you know, I'm not some freaking Einstein rocket scientist with 10 PhDs and $10 million and whatever. I'm just somebody with an opinion, and I'm speaking out, you know, and just saying what I think and all that. And, you know, now I got Kristen, who's like, whoops. Silly browser. Kristen is asking if I'm still on. Let's get the page back here. But anyway, you know, y'all get my point, hopefully. So let's move beyond this whole, you know, poor little me complex that we're trained to have and, you know, think like, I'm just getting bombarded, aren't I? I'm on the air. Have anything to say to the internet? Didn't think so. Sorry about that. That is definitely, when you're busy doing stuff and you don't want to be disturbed, and what you're doing is you're on the air talking to people, it's definitely one way to respond to knocks at the door and stuff, because most people tend to want to shy away from this, which is synchronistically in alignment with exactly what I was just saying. People like, oh, I don't want to get on there. I don't want to make waves. What good could I be? What could I possibly do? And they just kind of curl up and hide in their cave. It's like, oh, I don't want to get out in front of people. No. I can't speak my mind. No. Well, yeah, you can. And it can be fun, and you could make a few bucks in the process. And, it's not this horrible torture. And it doesn't matter that you're just, you're one person and the world doesn't know who you are. Who gives a shit? Make some videos, have some fun, pass them around. And even if you only inspire 10 people ever, just remember the domino effect. So you can still do your part. You can still have fun doing it, whatever. It's cool. So yeah, fuck these smart meters, piece of fucking shit, and raise awareness about that. Spread this video around. Feel free to download it, re-upload it to your channel if you want. You could use Easy YouTube Downloader, Video Download Helper, anything like that. Those are plugins for Mozilla Firefox and all that. And I'm going to respond to Kristen right quick. Yes, I am. Would you like to join in? Who all is on? Rich had to go to work, so just me rambling. If no one else comes on, I'm probably just gonna close it down soon. Yes. Again, this is about the meters. Yes, it is about the meters. See, I was actually about to state that I'm going to be, closing this down soon if nobody else pops on. So everything in synchronistic alignment here. So, you going to come on?
Hello.
Just kind of checking to see if she's going to hop on or not. If not, I'm probably just going to give my final thoughts and close this down. And if so, then we could get her take on smart meters and all that good stuff. And by good, I mean fucked. No idea if she's going to be coming on or not. I guess I'll find out soon enough here, won't I? And this chat is being visually recorded. Screen share presentation.
Hey! I've tried. Are you there, Dave? Shit. Hello? Can you hear me? Can you see me? Hello? Hello? Hello, hello.
This is where some Jeopardy theme music could probably come in good. Do do do.
Dave. Do, do, do. Oh my God. Do 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 do.
Oh my God, I've been trying to join. It says I'm in the call right now. Really? Oh, yeah, there you are, sort of.
Hello?
Oh, wait a minute. Now I can. Yeah, I had my volume. Yeah, hello. I had my volume turned down because nobody else was here, and I forgot to turn it back up. My bad.
Oh, that's okay.
Yeah, I had it. I had it turned down because, you know, Rich left, and I had gotten through playing all the, you know, all the video content stuff, and it was just me kind of rambling, so I had my volume turned down, just I didn't need it up.
Oh. Yeah, it took a while for your audio to come in, but it eventually did, so.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't see you, but I most certainly hear you. Your audio is coming in without any problem, so.
All right, yay! I wasn't sure how this whole connection thing was going to work, but I am doing it downstairs near the Wi-Fi, so I think it'll work out good.
Yeah. Is your camera enabled?
Yes.
Because I don't see shit, but I hear you just fine.
It's showing my camera right now. It says it's going, so.
Weird. Let me try disabling my screen share, seeing as I'm done presenting anyway, and see if maybe that.
You look ominous right now.
There you are. And now I finally saw you. Like, cool. I don't see you in the little screen, but I see, okay, there we go, in the bigger screen. This is weird the way it's acting right now. It's a bit of a weirdo.
It was
were you watching any part of the presentation at all, or have you just joined in, or what?
I have just joined in. I haven't watched any of it, but I did read the article that you shared with me about the whole meters thing, the energy meters, and I think it's a little weird how they're forcing it upon people. I think people should see a little bit deeper into why.
It's a bit shady.
Yeah, it just sounds like another scam that they're trying to force on the public, like something that's harmful for you, but they're trying to package it in a way so it's like, hey, we're doing you a favor. It's going to be so much more convenient to track your energy and everything else that you're doing, you know?
Eat McDonald's burgers. They're completely healthy. They're healthier than a freaking salad, man. They're healthier than non-GMO salads. Just eat that McDonald's burger. Eat 10 of them at a low price of $5, you know? And it's like...
Pretty much.
Just like they do with diet pop, too. It's like,
Ooh,
diet. Great. New yummy refreshing taste. You know, it's like they may as well be talking about dog shit. Like, eat new wonderful tasting dog shit with cat piss, you know. And it's like, yeah, right. This is supposed to be like, oh, yummy, nummy, num. So, tastes so great. Right.
I mean, Diet Pop, I've never understood Diet Pop, for one thing. Okay, it's not really any better for you than normal pop, okay? When you talk about the artificial sweeteners and everything
it's
else.
It's actually way worse, but that's a whole
it's worse for you, like health benefit-wise. Okay, obesity, but for one thing, you can drink pop and not be obese. Also, if you're going for it, why not go for the good taste? I mean, some people prefer diet taste, but I just can't deal with it.
I think it's all a part of the television hypnosis, because remember, as we've talked about before, physical reality technically being holographic and, you know, believing is seeing. People that are more weak-minded, you can basically, like, hypnotize them into thinking that something that tastes like shit actually tastes good. It's like reprogramming the brain.
That's horrible.
That's actually how, like, a lot of onstage hypnotists and stuff have actually done things. Like, when they hypnotize people and make people think that they're eating an apple when they're really eating a potato or vice versa, you know what I mean? And it's just kind of like the hypnotic reprogramming.
Mind over matter. It's a real thing.
That's a whole other, like, conversation, you know? It's just, like, there's entire documentaries that have been written about, like, you know, TV and TV ads and subliminals and alpha waves and just, you know, how all that can, you know, affect people and just, like, entrain people. And that's why so many people got mad at, like, Teletubbies, because it's, like, the all-time youngest age targeting for, you know, that sort of brainwashing.
Funny how you mentioned Teletubbies, because that show, I loved that show. That show was reaching its height when I was pretty young, which was the very late 90s and early 2000s and stuff. And I watched that show so much. I don't know how it was programming me, but anything that you spend time watching is going to leave some kind of influence on you, you know. So I wouldn't be surprised if it did.
I remember a long time ago. I used to have this friend by the name of Kelly, and she was a single mother, and she had this little girl by the name of Colleen, and I think Colleen was like 2 or 3 at the time. Colleen had this little Teletubby doll, and like when you squeezed it talked. I forgot which Teletubby it was or whatever, but what it was supposed to be saying is, big hug! But the way that doll said it, it sounded like it was saying, Sieg Heil! I was like, oh my god, Teletubby Nazi!
Whoa, that's frightening.
I was like, oh my god, yeah. And then, like,
that's funny.
Other disturbing children's toys, like things that you hit buttons and they talked and stuff. Like there was for sounding out words and letters and stuff. And like I was able to make it say like fucker, and like that cock, and like all sorts of stuff. And it's just like, it's just like, wow, one of these days we should really go into Toys R Us and do that, you know? Like, actually go, if they got, like, the live demo things with the batteries in it, like, yeah, make it say all sorts of nasty things right there in the Toys R Us line. We never did that, but, you know.
Welcome to the real world, kids.
Oh, yeah, really.
Quite funny. The whole Teletubby thing, that could just be like it needs some new batteries or something. It's making it sound all weird.
But it's just this real high pitch, like, it's trying to say Zeke-hun! But it's like the way it said it, it's like Zeke-hun! It's like, what the hell, Nazi Tubby? Uh-oh, I think your video feed... Are you still there? Oh, there you are.
Yes.
I thought I lost you for a second. Because your video is freezing, I hear your audio a little bit. Are you still there? Testing 1, 2, 3?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I turned off my camera.
Okay. Yeah, it was like choking up for a minute. Try turning it back on again.
All right. How long have you been in this hangout?
Oh, for a while, like at least a couple hours, something like that, if I had to guess.
Have some good discussion?
Yep. Now everything's working fine. I think, like, people have just, like, glitched and fucked up for a sec.
Probably got the kinks out when I turned off the camera.
Yeah, your audio and video is slightly out of sync, but I don't care, it's fine.
Yeah, that happens.
But at least I could see you and hear you instead of, like, everything, like, locking up and grinding to a halt. That was kind of weird.
Yeah.
Believe it or not, I actually have lights on in my room. They're all LED. It's fairly lit up for me, but the camera doesn't recognize it real well. I'd have to, like, sit really, like, super close. I don't feel like trying to make out with the screen, so, you know. You still there? Okay, it's like locked up a little bit again. Try turning video. Try turning video off, then back on. Well, at least we're getting a better signal than we expected.
Yeah, so... Oh!
Is Emily still over, or what?
No, she had to leave because she has to work tomorrow morning pretty early. But it was fun. We got to hang out and stuff.
Oh, cool. I'm glad things got better.
Yeah. So as far as the whole energy thing, I think, obviously, you know, they can try and force things on us all they want, but the best thing we can do is really just spread the awareness, like have conversations like these about it, because if we, you know, when people just stop caring about what they feel is best, like if you don't have an opinion, you don't share your opinion, what you think is corrupt isn't going to change, you know?
So. Yeah, it's really about raising awareness, like that's the first step. I mean, it's not the last step. I mean, I hate it that people think that you know, when they go out and protest, that they're actually forcing corporations to do anything or forcing them to give a shit or whatever. No, what they're doing is they're waking up their fellow human beings. I mean, when people get out and protest, like, corporations just laugh and shit. Like, okay, what's that supposed to do? Because when people are protesting, they're still framing it in the context of, we demand you make the change for us. And, you know, that's still showing, you know, the ruling class that we're disempowered and we're not, you know, we're not willing to do for ourselves. That would be like in World War II on the battlefield, yelling to the Nazis, we demand you shoot yourselves on the battlefield. And, like, obviously, if that were to literally happen, the Nazis would just laugh and be like, okay, the Allied troops aren't willing to defend themselves. They're trying to talk us into shooting ourselves. So let's just carpet bomb them and be done with it.
This reminds me of something that I was talking about with Daniel today. A friend of ours started talking about how he believes that, you know, he was a disbeliever for a while, but now he's gotten back into believing in the Bible and the prophecy and everything. And he thinks that basically the end times are upon us and Revelations is coming and stuff. And then I show Daniel the video about mental malware by Larkin Rose. And basically, we got into some good discussion. And I really think that one of the biggest motivation for people doing protests like that and, you know, leaving and things is because people would rather point the finger of blame as to why the world is the way it is instead of owning up to their part in it. Like, the reason the world is the way it is with the big class of elites taking advantage of the populace, it isn't just because the elites are psychopaths. They're going to be psychopaths no matter what. It's the fact that people think they have some kind of authority over us. That is the only problem.
Yeah, I mean, it's okay to recognize that a rattlesnake is a rattlesnake and that it is what it is, but right. to point at the rattlesnake and say, rattlesnake, I expect you to make the changes for me in my life that I want to make, that's stupid.
Mm-hmm. Because those psychopaths that are ruling the world, they aren't going to change. They're justified in their own ways. But we have to realize our compliance is a great part in the way things are. And like Larkin Rose said, you know, people who are truly good people, they have this belief system that they are only good when they're following what the law says and when they're paying their taxes.
You know? Law-abiding taxpayers, you know. I give money to a group of criminals and gladly do whatever they say, you know. It's like people don't realize what they're saying.
And they don't
realize that, you know, like things like income taxes, if they really research into it, not a penny of income tax goes into infrastructure or anything for the people. It just goes into the pockets of the bankers. Prior to there being income tax, the states were able to generate their own revenue, and there was a time in American history where the states were so prosperous they were bragging about it.
Yeah.
That was before the IRS came in and started stealing everybody's money.
Yep, the feds.
IRS is an arm of the Federal Reserve Bank, which is about as federal as Federal Express, and it's a private corporation. Most people don't know that. You know, if I could make one amendment to the Constitution, I would make an amendment that prohibited government from borrowing money. So
why?
it would be forced to make its own. The Fed would go bye-bye in a second. You see, that's what Lincoln and Kennedy have in common. Both have the same idea. Lincoln wanted to make the greenback, which was an equity-based currency, so he got killed for that. And Kennedy had, you know, the silver certificates and gold certificates, things like that. They weren't Federal Reserve. So that's one of the main reasons Kennedy got offed. So the only two presidents in history to be assassinated were the only two that wanted to break away from the banksters.
Now, isn't that just a bit of a coincidence?
Oh, yeah, sure. Coincidence, maybe. Not coincidence.
Also, I think it's interesting how they had, like, they have all the similarities and the number of letters in their name, and there's just all these kind of weird coincidences between the two presidents, and I find it also strange how, yeah, they were the two that got assassinated, and they were the two that tried to bring in the whole banking thing, so there you go.
Yeah, they tried to break away from it. Hell, back in the day, President Jackson ran under the platform of Jackson and no bank.
Oh yeah, I remember you telling me about that.
He called the bankers a den of vipers, if I recall correctly.
They are.
Yep. And it's the bankers in Wall Street that are in charge of things like the power companies. you know, they wield that influence. They're invested in utility corporations and then some.
It's how it works, you know. And most of the time, you know, they're doing all the stuff that they do under a banner of, hey, we're here for the population. And I always find it funny how people say, the people, the citizens of the United States are the government. No. We're not a democracy as much as people want to say we are.
Well, I'll correct you there. We are a democracy. Democracy means rule of mafia. What the founding fathers set up was a democratic republic.
Yeah, because we elect the people to go and then do the whole democracy thing.
Democratic republic means you've got the proper due process. Whereas a democracy, a mob, a mafia, a lynch mob, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
A democracy is rule of wolves over the sheep. We have that. We don't have a democratic republic like we used to.
Damn. Well, and we're also pretty heavily influenced by corporations. I mean, when you
and
really get down...
corporations are co-opted by the bankers.
Yep.
Like Mayor Amschel Rothschild once said, give me a control of the nation's money supply, and I don't care who makes the laws.
Pretty much. I mean, that's where all the power lies. That's the way it's been.
Funny thing is the power really lies in our belief in that system of currency, not in the currency itself. Currency's just paper.
Good point.
In this day and age, it's not even paper. It's numbers on a computer.
Right.
Something like 90% of the money in circulation doesn't physically exist.
That is so bizarre to me. And yet we believe in concepts of debt. That does not add up to me.
Well, in a fiat money system, money literally is debt. If every debt was paid off, there wouldn't be a dollar in circulation. Money isn't simply created at a debt, it's created as debt.
Dude.
That's why the word, you know, the word debit card, you know, if you look at the spelling of debit, the word is pronounced debt.
Right.
It's a debt card. It doesn't say it's a money card. It doesn't say it's a currency card. It doesn't say it's an equity card. It says it's a debt card. And what does a debt card do? It withdraws, right?
Yes. Very interesting.
A debt card withdraws debt. That's what it's for.
And funny how, you know, the whole credit card, which is the one where you actually get charged to use, that's not called the debt card. The one that is just supposedly you using the money that you've already earned is the debt. Yeah, that's a bit peculiar. But,
well,
they have to, how
it operates, with all this stuff... They have to put the truth out in front of everybody's face at, like, a subliminal level.
Ew, you're right.
That's the only way the human mind can deal with it and accept it. Because, I mean, think of it like how a teenager might react. Whenever you tell a teenager, no, you can't do that because I said so, the first thing they want to do is go and do it anyway. So if all these different systems of government, corporation, whatever, if they just said, do it because I said so, you need no explanation, everybody just instantly rebel. But they don't do that. They put everything out in front of everybody to provide people the illusion of choice. So people are like, oh, we have a choice. And they slip everything in subliminally.
Mm-hmm.
Remember what I said about, like, like, society teaches us to view the world as a world of words, and words are just variables in an equation, and the word equation is synonymous to the word problem. So if we're taught to think everything in life is an equation to be solved, then we're thinking everything in life is a problem. So the only real reality is problems, is chaos, is drama, is conflict, is war. That's the only real reality. There is no other. So it's deep fucking mind control.
Oh, yeah.
Subtle, subliminal.
And that's how it works.
And that's how marketing works. I mean, you know, anybody who knows anything about marketing, they're taught how to deal with psychological marketing. They're taught how people's minds works and how to use that. And that deals with a lot of symbolism and subconscious associations between things.
You know, I find it kind of funny how even my history teacher said in front of the class, nowadays, school does serve as a form of indoctrination. And I think it's interesting because, you know, not only is my history teacher saying this, when you start to look into the, you know, whole school agenda, it is a form of indoctrination, especially how they run things.
Has he ever talked about the history of education and the Prussian education system?
No, he hasn't. But my point
might want to bring that up to him.
I'm going to do more research on it before I do. But anyways, if I do, I'm going to do more research first.
Obviously. Oh, I can give you plenty to research that. I can give you plenty to sink your teeth into, and then you could put something together and be like, hey, what do you think of this? And he'll, you know, either it'll be something he already has known about but he's been keeping quiet about, or it'll completely shock him, like, whoa, dude, I didn't even know this.
Awesome. Either way, good.
I mean, there's so many teachers that don't even know the history of the educational system.
Oh, I believe it. So what I was saying is, when in schools, they'll teach you about propaganda. You know, they'll teach you about how some leaders were able to influence their populaces.
And they put it in the past tense, so subliminally you're thinking that doesn't happen anymore.
Exactly. And so when you're thinking that, you know, unless you dig deeper, when you're just told that you're getting an education, but you don't know what kind of an education and how many forms. And let me tell you, it's more than just trivia and academics. More than just the subjects at school. They're teaching you, basically, how to be the kind of citizen that they want you to be. Now, kids reject it a lot of times, but...
And the core operating system of the brain doesn't really know how to differentiate anything from any other thing. It doesn't know the difference between internal and external. It doesn't know the difference between self and other. And it has no way of knowing that, okay, I'm going to take in this piece of information, but I'm only going to apply it to this one thing. Nope. The brain applies all information to all other information. So, wow. You know, you think you're learning, okay, this concept I'm learning only applies to this one thing right here, and that's it. But that's only what you're telling yourself on the conscious level. On the subconscious level, it applies to everything. And that's why when you get programmed into a pattern, a routine, a belief system about how to conduct yourself in school, you know, everything has to be done like this, there's deadlines and this and this, and this has to be done that way, and da-da-da-da-da. Your entire thinking, your total perception of reality becomes that. So even when you're not in school, that is your perception of reality in its totality, period.
And you want to know something? Okay, that's exactly what I told him. I said, a big reason why school serves as indoctrination is because the way that there's deadlines for things to be done and the way you have to be at the same place every time each day It's indoctrinating you into the idea that life is, you have to go somewhere, aka a job, every day, do work, which is supposed to be done at the right time. He said, yeah, and he said, well, really what school's doing with that is they're getting you ready for the workforce to go out and actually have real-world jobs. And I said, okay. But what we don't understand when we're indoctrinated like that is that it's setting us up that we start to think that that is the only way things can be. But it's just not. It's only that way when we think it is. We can find other ways of being where we don't need to be somewhere every day, you know, where we don't need to have unending deadlines for ourselves.
Well, it programs us to be obedient and it disables critical thinking.
And yeah, exactly.
Did you tell him that?
And also, basically I said, when we're in schools, we're taught that we have to take things as you tell us, and if not, we have to face the consequences. I said, and honestly, we have no control over, we don't know much about the outside world. We know very little if what we're being told is true or not. We're just supposed to take it because we're told it's true.
But did you tell him that that completely disables critical thinking?
No, but I also sent him the video of Mental Malware by Larkin Rose. I emailed it to him. Hopefully he'll watch. A while ago, I also emailed him the What is Anarchy video. He's a very intelligent teacher, and he's a very intelligent person. And he's the only history teacher I've ever known to go so far as to tell the students, you know, our history book is biased, and our history book leaves out important things. And our history book, you know, and he also, like I said, he did straight up admit that there's indoctrination in our school system, which I think is more than a lot of teachers will do.
Exactly.
So that's why I sent him this stuff, because I thought he could actually be receptive to it.
And he might figure out a way to apply it to his classes in the future.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm, you know, normally I don't even, with some people, I don't even bother sharing my opinions because I just know, you know, it's not going to get well received and that's okay. But if I think that there's a chance someone's going to understand or, you know, it could be beneficial to them, I'll go ahead and share.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's awesome. You know, an actual teacher becoming aware of the problems.
Yeah, well.
Well, the path.
You know that one guy by the name of Larry that was at that Byron Katie thing with Katarina? Remember that synchronicity?
Yes.
Well, he used to be a school teacher.
Oh, wow.
And he was originally from Chicago, too.
Interesting.
And I suggested that he, you know, maybe on his own YouTube channel he could talk about what a crock of shit the current school system is from the perspective of a former school teacher, and he liked the idea.
Oh, cool! I hope he does that. Can't have too much of that.
And he's been watching the Paradigm Shift videos. He's been kind of focused on going through all the hangouts that we've had, you know, prior. So, I'm sure he's already probably seen you.
Oh, sweet. I'm glad I got to join in on this hangout today. I wonder how
he would have been on today if not for the fact that he was busy.
Sweet, he sounds interesting. How old is he?
Oh, he's even older than my dad. He was born in 1944.
Oh my gosh, that's so cool. So, whoa, how old is he?
70s? Let's see. Yeah, that would put him in about 70, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm. My grandma was born in 39, and she's in her 70s, so yeah. I just figured. Very interesting. People of all ages can, you know, make their own kinds of change. It's cool.
Yeah, it's nice to see some of the older people, you know, waking up more and putting their experience to use.
Mm-hmm.
in a more productive way.
Yes, I agree. Oh, Dave, okay, so what I was going to tell you, speaking of owning up to our own stuff, okay, so, you know the whole, how my dad was going to give me a bit of money early on, and I was going to use it to try to get my, like, a new computer and stuff to get my YouTube channel going up more?
Yep.
Well, he says he might not be able to do that because he made a couple bad financial decisions or something. So I was feeling a bit down because I was kind of looking forward to that money, but I decided to ask my mom if she could pay me a little bit of money if I would clean up the whole house. So she's going to pay me, like, well, I'm not sure how much, but she said over $100, and I'm going to clean up the whole house.
Really? So,
yeah, I'm going to clean the basement, which is really messy.
Hold on a minute again. Still on the air, what's up?
You don't have to watch Katie. She's
okay.
She's going to stay home with Connie.
Okay.
These make me more... Melatonin don't do much for me. These make me tired.
Okay.
I had to get two for one. So.
Okay. Thanks. Yep, sorry about that. Please do continue.
Okay, so she's gonna pay me a bit to clean the basement, the sun porch, and the garage, and they're all really messy. Basically, I think I told you a bit how my mom is a compulsive shopper, so she gets a lot of stuff, and she likes the deals, so, and basically it'll just end up in containers in the basement or all over the floor, and so I think it's cool how, you know, I'm going to be getting it cleaned up, which I want, which I'm going to benefit from, but she said she would pay me.
I would also suggest that as you're cleaning it up, organize it in whatever way that you feel is easiest for you to access. I know I've been doing my best to make things around here more organized and efficient, because obviously it helps to know where things are and
oh, yeah.
Things lost, so.
Oh, and I'm going to be getting rid of a whole bunch of bullshit. That's just, it's pretty much, there's stuff in the basement that no one's looked at for years and years, and it's just time for it to go. I mean, we have this giant...
What are you going to be doing with it?
Throwing a lot of it out, giving some of it away.
Well, anything that isn't, like, total broken down crap that's still usable... You know, find a local thrift store or something and dump it off on them. I know as I've been going through my stuff, you know, anything that, you know, I really don't want anymore and, you know, have no use for, you know, I've been putting it in boxes and taking it over to this one thrift store called I think AJ&A Thrift or whatever it's called. But, you know, periodically I'll just take boxes of stuff into them and, you know, that way they benefit and... It's not just being thrown out because it's still stuff that could be used. And, you know, they always cut me deals and stuff when they have stuff that, you know, I need and whatever. They, you know, drop their prices down really cheap because, I mean, I probably spent, like, at least $1,000 in that place at this point. So they definitely want to keep my business coming.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, I'm sure I can find a place like that. There's this store called Plato's Closet, and if I have pretty nice clothing that's just gently used, I'll take it there and sell it. I've done that a couple times. A lot of extra clothing that I've had, I'll just take to Goodwill because I didn't even actually think of thrifting anything until you mentioned it, so I could do that.
I mean, it doesn't just have to be clothes. I mean, anything. Old toys,
yeah.
Electronics, whatever. Anything, really. As long as it still works. And it's not, like, in, like, total disarray or anything, you know? If it's just a matter of you don't want it anymore, then, you know, dump it off at a thrift store so they can sell it to somebody who does want it.
I think there's going to be a lot of stuff that is like that. But there's also going to be a lot of stuff that's just broken and trashed because it's just been on the floor for years, so I wouldn't be surprised.
Well, then anything that's broken, recycle whatever is recyclable if you have those sorts of facilities.
Mm-hmm.
If not, then, you know, then you can't help that you don't, but if you do, then use them.
Yeah, we have recycling that comes by once a week and good stuff, so.
With ours, it's once every 2 weeks, but yeah. The big blue bins.
Oh, we have, well, they gave everyone one normal size black bin, like probably 2 by 3 feet or something around that size. And we have so much recycling that we have to have 4 of those that size. We got our grandma to give us 2, and then I forget how, but we ended up getting a second black one. But yeah, we have a lot of recycling, and
they only give us 1 for recycling and 2 for regular garbage. And they only pick up the recycling once every couple of weeks. It's stupid.
Yeah. It's
better than nothing.
They give us 1 giant trash bin, and they get everything every week. The thing is, though, yesterday we were supposed to have everything out in the morning for them to come by with the recycling, but we forgot to do it, so we're basically going to have 2 weeks worth of trash and recycling, and I don't know where we're going to put it because we have so much bullshit, but yeah, so that's a bit annoying.
Also, I'll remind you, as far as your YouTube channel, give yourself permission to start at the beginning. That means if all you have is your cell phone and that's it, use it.
Right, it's a start.
Exactly.
Oh my god, and you know what? That's honestly a big reason why I did this hangout. I mean, it's one thing because I know we haven't really been talking that much about the actual topic, but I do feel strongly about that topic, obviously. And I just want to start. I can't expect to get my channel going if I don't participate. You know,
a lot of people are under the illusion that, oh, they have to have a really good computer and a really good cam and a working knowledge of video editing and this and that. And they have this big list of things that they think they need before they can even take the first step. But the problem is that in order to get all those things, you have to take the first step. So it's like a negative feedback loop that spirals and goes nowhere. It's like, oh, I need all the stuff in order to take the first step, but in order to get all that stuff, I have to take the first step. So it like collapses in on itself. And it's all an illusion. You don't need any of that shit.
Yeah. And I think, see, I have this idea that, you know, I have certain ideas for projects, you know, videos, little skits, comedy stuff that I want to do.
And that could be later.
Right, exactly. I was thinking, why not use what I have now, get going on other projects that I want to do, and when I get to a semi-big project that I want to make look really nice, well, hopefully by then I'd have a camera, or I can use what I have now to, like, get a rough draft of the kind of comedy or whatever kind of project I want to do.
And or look at what we're doing right now. There's nothing stopping you from loading up a Google Hangout consisting of one person, that being you, and speaking your thoughts into the dang cell phone.
Right.
You know, all these discussion topics and you want to get your thoughts out? Nothing's been stopping you from getting your thoughts out but you. You are the only thing that's been stopping you. That's it. You've had the ability for quite some time. You just had a perfectionist complex about it, that before mentioned list of things that you think you need, but you don't.
Well, I can't deny that. That is true. But I also think when I'm talking about a lot of these topics, I know there is a start, and at the start you don't have as many subscribers and followers as you do later on. But to me, when I'm talking about these big topics, I know there's nothing wrong with making a second video on a subject, but for a while, I couldn't that wasn't even an option in my mind, so I was thinking, hey, well, I'm going to be talking on this, and I might just get a couple views, you know, so what's the point? But the thing is, you're never going to get more views with that kind of mentality. The point is, put your opinion out there and record yourself doing it or whatever because you like doing it.
Yep, and not to mention, you might get 20,000 views 2 years from now.
Years from now.
But if you never make the video in the first place, then 10 years from now, you won't have any views on a video that never existed.
Very true. And also, there's some YouTubers and, you know, other people who, they'll post a video, and out of nowhere, that video will get a lot of, it'll go kind of viral.
And it won't even necessarily be that great. Some of them are just like the stupidest things ever, and they just go viral.
And you'll get like a shit ton of subscribers, and then they'll notice on some of your other stuff. Some stuff is just, you happen to make a cute little video collage of kittens or something like that, and it just so happens to get thousands of views because people love that shit. And basically, because you posted that one little video, people will subscribe to you, and then, you know, you got a bunch of subscribers. What are you going to do with that? Make more videos. It's awesome.
People, a lot of people also love to hear, like, empowered chicks just be real and raw and rant about stuff. Because what people are sick of is, you know, chicks getting all emo and self-victimized and like, well, life sucks and that's the only real reality and fuck you and fuck everybody and my life is so horrible and spiraling into that without end, you know, that whole drama. People are sick of that, and what they really want that they never see is just, you know, people being, you know, just like real and raw about stuff like what Leia used to be, what Katarina...
Right, I was just about to mention her. I will... Hold on 1 second. I will be right back.
Okay. After these messages, she'll be right back.
All right, I'm back.
Yep. But yeah, you know, I mean, just people having the balls to be themselves. Because, you know, at that point, it doesn't matter whether a girl is in a good mood or a bad mood or whether she's complaining about something or she's happy about something. Mm-hmm. Because she's being real and being genuine, it all kind of comes together with a sense of purpose. And it's not just a girl being like, I'm feeling sorry for myself. Give me sympathy and everybody feels sorry for me too. You know what I mean?
It's just someone being genuine about how they feel.
Exactly, which in this society is a lot more rare than it should be.
Pretty much.
There's one thing people need to understand. It's not rare because nobody thinks like that. It's rare because most of the people who think like that are afraid to fucking speak. And if they don't speak, nobody knows they exist.
So it's about people like Katarina, like Leia, having the courage to speak and having the courage to go against things that say they aren't good enough to speak how they feel.
Yeah, and just like, you know, you used to try to tell me, like, but Dave, most of society thinks and feels this other way. They don't think and feel like I do. And I'm like, first of all, you can't speak for most of anybody. Nobody can. And second of all, it's not that nobody thinks and feels like you do. It's just similarly to you, they won't speak up, and if they don't speak, nobody knows they exist.
Mm-hmm.
So you're finally starting to realize that.
And it's really, to me, it reflects back the whole you know, the mirror will never smile at you first, meaning the external circumstances, you know, they're always going to reflect what's inside of you first. So,
there's tons of chicks out there like you who totally are afraid to talk, so nobody know they exist.
Right. So to me,
it's people like you who encourage them to speak.
And that's what I want to do. I know there's a lot of other women with the same ideas as me, a lot of other people with the same ideas as me, and they just really want to help people be more comfortable with being themselves, want to help people learn to accept themselves, and really just want to get this message of empowerment and people having control over their reality. I just want to get that out there. And I realize, you know, I'm not necessarily unique in that, but everyone's their own different expression of that, you know? So I can do things my own way, and I might be similar to other people, which is something that I've been a bit worried about, but
a lot of people also think that they have to be some guru with 2 decades of experience in order to have the right to talk about this stuff. Otherwise, if they do it before then they're being a hypocrite.
But the thing is,
which is totally not true.
Processing it, that people are way more susceptible to that because it looks like something they can even more relate to. I mean, not that there's anything wrong with the whole guru shaman thing, but there's also nothing wrong with someone just expressing themselves in the moment, regardless of how many shitty belief systems they might still have.
And then people start to realize that they're not alone, because before that they thought they were the only one in the universe who felt that way, and that they're just some weirdo outcast that, you know, just needs to stay away from people, and, you know, in order to avoid taking shit, because obviously no one could understand them, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and, you know, it's not true.
Right. You just keep building up the walls, but it also, the whole, what Larkin Rose mentioned and what a lot of people say, excuse me, you have to want the truth more than to remain in your comfortable belief systems. So when you see someone, you know, being very open about how they felt about things before, which may not have been very positive, but you also see them willingly exploring other things, that is something that is a complete shock to people's belief systems. Not only are they seeing, hey, there can be other options, you're observing someone basically showing you how to do that.
You're observing someone doing things that you always believed were impossible for anyone to do.
Accepting the bad parts of yourself, but also allowing something else, just because you're letting go of the resistance against it.
Not bad, but I'll say dysfunctional.
Right. I think, and you're right about, you know, pointing out the whole bad thing, because when things get labeled as bad, there's often this feeling that it's not allowed to be there.
Yeah, and remember, the brain doesn't know the difference between you and your totality and just a part of you. So when you label a part of yourself as bad, your brain interprets it as, I am bad in my totality. I am horrible. I am miserable. I am unworthy. I am undeserving.
And it's only when you start to realize that's only part of yourself that you basically have to kind of remind yourself of that. Because, and I think that's a big difference. When I was really, really depressed,
mm-hmm.
it, you know, it's a day-to-day thing, that was because I was thinking, this is the only reality. And now when I get sad, it's kind of like, you know, I let myself feel sad. And sometimes I have feelings like, why am I feeling sad? I shouldn't be feeling this way. But other times, I just let myself feel sad and then it passes, really.
You're learning how to give yourself the right.
Exactly. And all our emotions are okay. And I'm just done pushing away parts of myself and compartmentalizing parts of myself that, you know, it's all valid. It all has a right to be here. And if I choose to clean up some of the, what I would call the mess, I'm allowed to, but you can't clean up the mess by shoving it under the rug.
Yeah, I mean, everybody has, you know, the capability of being Hitler, Mother Teresa, and everything in between. So when we realize that everyone has all these capabilities, and at the risk of sounding, you know, corny, bringing, you know, what we're thinking, feeling, and doing just totally into the now and being present, then we have this awareness of, wow, I can actually really just choose who I want to be in this moment. I'm realizing I could be nice, I could be rude, I could be good, I could be a real bastard, I could, you know, there's all these potentials. Yeah. And it's just like, what do I want to do? Completely independent of what society says I should or shouldn't, what do I want to do? And the majority of people, I think, will realize that what they want to do is just live life in such a way that, you know, people aren't fucking with them and they're not fucking with anybody else. Just a mutual, you know, living life and doing the best they can and, you know, just having a peaceful life that nobody really truly expects life to be absolutely perfect, but I think everybody else knows, at least on some level, that life shouldn't be a total nightmarish hell either. That, you know, that and that when we go through hard times, it's a learning experience. It doesn't make us horrible or weak or stupid or whatever. I mean, there's a difference between a person sometimes doing a really stupid thing and a person being stupid, you know.
Yeah.
There's a difference between these two ideas. It's like the idea of occasionally someone will trip and fall versus the idea of tripping and falling is the only thing they ever do in their reality. You know, I mean, it's, you know, everybody trips and falls sometimes, no matter how careful they are.
Yeah.
Especially here in Chicago with all the snowfall lately and the ice building up under there. You know, one wrong step, no matter how careful, you're on your ass. Doesn't make you horrible.
That's embarrassing in public, even though it happens to a lot of people. Poor people and slipping. I slipped the other day, but I didn't even slip on ice. I was walking in this set of, like, this really tiny set of woods, like, the only woods in Covington that aren't private property, and there's this little trail, and I kind of walk back there. It's not the prettiest woods, because right now they're really barren, but
yeah.
So I'm walking, and it's kind of wet, I guess. It's snowing a bit. And there's kind of like...
That's what I love about Chicago. We got lots of woods here, and I don't think there are any woods here that are quote-unquote private property. It's all public.
That's amazing.
I mean, granted, the woods and the, and you know, most of the parks and stuff, they do close at sunset, but that's only because, you know, if they didn't have that law, there'd probably be a lot more murders.
Yeah, you know? Dude. There's probably quite a bit of murder in Chicago. It's so big. That's funny.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not funny, but there's no murder in Chicago.
I mean, you know, it's like there's a lot when you total it up, but I mean, when you look at the amount of murders versus the amount of people, it's like so highly unlikely that you're going to get murdered. It's not even funny, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, you know, just in the greater Chicagoland area, I'd say there's probably anywhere between, like, 15 to 25 million people or something like that. So, I mean, you know, even if there's, like, you know, 2,000 murders a year or something, you might look at 2,000 and be like, oh my God, that's such a big number. But then look at how many people there are. It's like if you were to really, like, reduce that scale, it would be like if you're looking at a population of, like, 100,000 and saying there's, like, one murder. You know what I mean? It's like, that's the type of scale you're working with.
And also, I mean, some people, to be honest, are more likely to get murdered than others. and depending on what area you live in. Like, Dave, you don't seem like you would have that high of a chance of getting murdered just because you don't really, you're not really, like, involved with anything on the streets. You're mostly inside your house, minding your own business.
Yeah, I mean, basically, I go through my life not screwing with people. I'm not dealing with crack dealers or gangbangers or mafia members or whatever. You know, I'm not out looking for trouble.
That's not Dave. So, yeah, you're probably...
Yeah, my likelihood is kind of less because I don't go out, you know, looking for trouble. And it's not like I live in, like, ghetto land or something.
Right.
You know, I'm not at risk of having stray bullets flying through my walls all the time or anything like that.
I'm really glad. This has been an inspiring talk, my friend.
My neighborhood does have the occasional shooting, but it's so rare. But in, like, the more ghetto areas, shootings are common.
Oh, I bet. It's a big-ass city.
Oh, yeah. I think people sometimes forget how big it is. Like, you know, people are like, oh, I heard there's this place over there in Chicago. Do you know where that is? It's like, nope, never heard of that. Oh, I'm surprised I never heard of it. You're in Chicago. It's like, dude, it's a big fucking city. I can't have heard of everything that exists everywhere up in this place. This place is huge.
Right. How do you know the miles, like the radius or whatever?
Oh, I don't know. I'd have to look. But the thing is, there's Chicago, then there's the greater Chicagoland area. Because if you look on a map and you see what constitutes a Chicago, that's only a line on a map. Like, if you were driving out on the streets here on the borders of Chicago, if you weren't looking at the signs that says, that say, you know, you have exited Chicago and entered into this suburb or whatever, you still think you were in Chicago. It's not like there's some drastic change in the architecture or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You could, like, drive for, like, you know, a half hour beyond Chicago, and if you didn't know any better, you'd still think you were in Chicago if you really just weren't paying attention.
That is a big-ass city.
And so, I mean, we've got a shitload of suburbs, and the farther out you go, the suburbs are done in such a way to where the houses are farther and farther apart until you get way, way out, then you finally realize at that point you're in the middle of fucking nowhere when you see a house here, a house there, oh, look, there's a cow, oh, there's a cornfield, you know. Then you know you've officially entered bumblefuck, but... You know, it's a gradual progression. It's not like you cross a line on the street and on one side everything's totally different from the other side. It's really just a gradual change as you keep going farther and farther away from the main city.
Dave, when was the last time that you left Chicago?
Chicago or the greater Chicagoland area? I mean, I live like 2 miles from you know, the west suburbs, so, you know, I mean, I'm right on the border anyway, so
okay,
it's
like... Okay, greater Chicagoland area.
Probably within the last, I don't know, 5 to 7 years ago or something. I mean,
oh my God,
with like prices the way they've been and the economy sucking and everything, it's like, people don't have the time or the money to really, like, you know, go way far out and do stuff. I remember when I was, like, you know, oh, I don't know, when was it? I don't know, a while back before the economy started getting, like, really crappy here. It's like, I lost track of how many times me and my friends would just, you know, jump in one of our vehicles or whatever and just pick a direction and fucking drive and purposely get ourselves lost and then find our way back, you know, just one of those little adventure, you know, road trip sort of things, just, you know, drive all the way out into the middle of bumblefuck and then make your way back, and, you know, you'd start at, like, you know, mid to late afternoon, early evening, something like that, and end up coming back home like 3-4 in the morning and shit. And, you know, yeah. I mean, you know, we did that kind of stuff, and, you know, just kind of seeing what else is around, and we, you know, we'd go into Indiana, and we'd go into Wisconsin, and we'd go all the way, like, southwest Illinois, and we'd do all sorts of crazy shit like that, but, you know, that was when money and, you know, was a little more prevalent, and the economy wasn't totally, like, you know. Mm-hmm.
That's cool. That sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, so we used to do all kinds of shit like that.
I'd like to do that eventually.
I'm sure eventually you will, especially if gas prices keep staying low. It's like, gas prices are at an all-time low.
Mm-hmm.
Have you noticed that?
It's strange.
It's like, you know, it hasn't been that low since, like, the early 90s. Early to mid-90s.
I wonder why.
Oh, that's a whole other topic. I could totally get into that, but not on this. Not
okay.
On this one, but I could totally get into that.
Let's wait till another day, okay?
Yeah, that's a whole other... I mean, at least the stuff about empowerment and being yourself in society and stuff has everything to do with perspectives on smart meters and getting people thinking in the direction of realizing that, yeah, they can do something about it, and they don't have to put the whole weight of the world on their shoulders. Just, you know, have the courage to just fucking talk and, you know, put their thoughts out there. And as awareness expands and people become more united, these corporations are, you know, able to do less and less and less. And, you know, I'm just waiting till there's enough shit that gets fucked up with this that the class action lawsuits really kick in, and then that'll be a lot of fun, and, you know.
It's just coming down to people are seeing how it's bullshit, and people don't all like bullshit being forced on them. So,
I mean, imagine if a million people said no at once. They don't have enough cops, enough lawyers, enough judges, enough jail cells, enough anything to actually be able to lock up and process all those people. And could you imagine how much, even if they could physically do that, which they can't, can you imagine how much paperwork that would suddenly inject into the system? The whole system would collapse just on red tape overload.
That is so true.
So there's no way they could do it. So if everybody stood up and said no, even if the court system totally blackballed everybody and said, nope, we're not allowing you to sue, we're not hearing any cases, Heil Hitler, we're all for the police state, fuck the people, fuck you, you're our bitch, kiss our ass. Even if the court system had that reaction, imagine a million people just standing up being like, nope, we're not going to let you put this shit in here. We're not going to let you do this. So, you know, what are you going to do? Send in airstrikes and, you know, bomb us all into oblivion? What are you going to do? You don't have enough police to arrest everybody. What are you going to do?
Reminds me of what Larkin Rose was talking about, you know, how the only reason authority has their power is because people actually believe in authority. So, just like, you know, us in government, it's a similar thing, you know, if we just decide we don't want to be ruled over anymore, they aren't going to rule over us, just like slaves if those slaves, you know, that we had back a couple hundred years ago, if they didn't believe in authority and they refused to be slaves, there were a lot of slaves down in the South. So,
yeah,
that population.
It's the slaves that abuse themselves as per the order of the slave master, the plantation owner. And it's become no different within our current, you know, society. Although people tend to go to two extremes with it. They, you know, some people think that, you know, if you just ignore and the system and refuse to participate, then it'll shut down. And then there's other people that think, well, you know, if you do that, that's like ignoring the roaches in the walls and just gives them power. Those are two equal and opposite extremes. People are looking at it like a light switching instead of a cake. Because it's true that if you have the majority of people saying, hey, we're no longer participating, fuck you, then it would be over in like 3 seconds. But if you only have a small handful of people trying to ignore the system, then yeah, you know, it'll build up like roaches in the walls and you'll be in trouble. But people always go to these, you know, these weird fucking extremes about things.
Yeah, like, they do.
Like, there was this one thing, let me find it here. I know, I posted this earlier. Oh, it looks like there's been a bunch more posts since last I checked. And you probably might have seen this, too. I don't know. Hold on, where's...
Is there any way to know how many people are watching this, if any?
Yes and no. Like earlier it said there were a couple of viewers. Right now it says there are zero, but those statistics are often not right. And then on top of it, it doesn't really matter who watches live or not, because this video is going to exist long after this point. So even if nobody's watching right now, it doesn't mean, you know, within the next 5 years there won't be a million people that'll see it. Doesn't mean there will, but doesn't mean there won't either, you know? So it's like, there's really no way to, you know, to really speculate on that. You know, whoever's going to see it is whoever's going to see it. It's, you know, it's just one of those things. What's up? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
What's up?
Hey.
What's up?
Okay, so...
I found it. I found what I was looking for.
All right.
There was this video someone made called The Matrix is Real, and it goes into the holographic nature of reality, and they're making the claim that, you know, because reality is literally based in a digital programming code, that it must mean that we are, you know, running in a computer simulation. And my comment on that is, to me, it's like asking the marital status of the number 5. No matter who might argue about the question, the participants don't realize that there's a problem with the question itself. We can only get answers that are as good as the questions we ask. To ask, are we living in a computer simulation, is a marital status of the number 5 sort of idea. It's not about whether we are or are not. It's that the question is inherently flawed. No one save for deep thinkers such as Einstein, etc., ever seemed to ponder the idea of what if computers are a simulation of reality? We made computers in our image, not the other way around. But the idea that energy, excuse me, but the idea that energy is the true nature of reality and that matter is the hologram has many people thinking that this is supposed to mean we are living inside of a computer program, as if energy is required to exist stored inside of some sort of physical container or battery.
Oh my God.
How many people stop to think, that maybe energy doesn't have this requirement, that maybe it is the limited scope of vision of the modern human being that is being imposed upon reality, that perhaps we are like the blind man touching the trunk of an elephant as we confidently profess that we have discovered a fire hose. So I'm not saying any of the data in this video is wrong. I'm just saying that our view of the data is narrow-minded because society teaches us to be narrow-minded. So instead of asking, are we living inside of a computer program, why not ask, are computers and programs a human imitation of reality? That maybe we're confusing the toy truck for the real truck, if you get my meaning. That maybe we've kind of got it all backwards. No one wants to ponder that, because both the proponents and the opponents of an idea have a primary goal of satisfying ego's addiction to feeling justified. It has nothing to do with getting at the truth. It has to do with the drug-like high we get from the false sense of having won.
So instead of, you know, when people are asking about reality being like a computer program, they don't like the idea of basically the way we perceive reality being like the computer program?
Well, they're stuck in this idea that which is non-physical needs to be surrounded by a physical container. Like, you know, how energy is stored in a battery.
So they think if
something is like a piece of software, then it needs to be installed inside of a computer. And a computer is a physical box. So that's the way they think about it. Instead of imagining that maybe energy doesn't need a fucking container, that maybe energy can exist on its own.
So instead of us actually being in a computer,
that energy is the true nature of reality, and that matter is the construct, and when we make computer software to run on our computers, we are mimicking reality, like a toy truck mimics a real truck.
Whoa.
Get what I'm saying?
Yes. So
we're mimicking it. We're it's a dumbed down mimic, like a toy truck to a real truck.
But it works.
Yeah. But it's a mimic. It doesn't mean that real trucks are made in the image of the toy truck. It doesn't mean that the toy truck is a real truck. It's an imitation. So as we start to realize that the toy truck and the real truck have something to do with each other, all of a sudden we start to say, well, real trucks must be toys then, because we've discovered the toy truck, so that must mean that real trucks are actually toy trucks. We totally put it backwards. Ass fucking backwards.
Right. Like, that is really, that question is bogus, because the computer is just the man-made structure basically harnessing the idea that it already exists.
It's an imitation. So we see that energy in the form of a hologram requires what we've labeled as a digital code. And keep in mind that the words digital code are just words. It's a label. Words are made up of letters, which are picture image symbols, and we string them together and we assign meaning to them. So the word digital code wouldn't mean anything without us assigning meaning to it. It would be like ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs, you know what I mean?
Yes.
So we're assigning our own subjective meaning to shit. And acting as if that's the way the universe works. Like, you know, we're higher than God. We say it is, so it is, you know. Like, as if nothing else could possibly be. It's arrogance to the utmost extreme.
What do you mean by digital code?
I mean that the idea of digital code is just an idea. It's two words. It's made up of letters. That the whole concept of digital code is just a concept out of human imagination, represented by picture symbols and defined according to human decision of conceptuality.
Right, I get that. Okay.
Kind of like in the Matrix movie, when Neo asked the program, you know what love is? And he's like, of course I know what it is. Love is a word. It's the connections that word represents that are important. You know, goes back to what I was saying is, we think the world is made of words and we treat it that way because we're taught to perceive reality that way in school. We don't differentiate between what a word is and what a thing is, you know what I mean? Like, we literally think that we are the words, that we are the tools. So that's why we so easily get used. You know what I mean?
Right, I get what you're saying.
We try to fit ourselves in.
My question was, you said that similarly to a computer, our reality uses something that is very similar to what our minds kind of define as a digital code. And I was asking you, well, what do you mean by that?
Well, here's one example. DNA, it's a 4-bit programming code. It's digital.
Okay.
See what I mean?
Yeah, I get that. Is that the only example?
Code is just mathematics. And when you start learning more and more deeper about how energy works, and I mean even deeper than I know about, I'm talking about like the mathematical pattern side of shit. Math is like one of my worst subjects. But for the really mathy quantum physicists that really love number patterns, they started to realize that energy follows mathematics, and mathematics is a digital code.
Especially
when you're talking about the advanced mathematics.
Oh, yeah. Math is fascinating. It's just all the patterns that exist. I just love it so much.
So science has started to see organized code. Some people have called this intelligent design.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard of that?
Yes. People use it to defend the existence of God.
No, the intelligent designers will not use the G word.
Well, some people have, but
yeah, they won't use the G word. They just simply say that the math supports the idea of the universe having been designed, and if it has been designed, it means there must be a designer. And so a lot of them, because they don't want to get religious and into the God thing, they try to get esoteric and just say that, you know, that basically consciousness essentially designed itself, so that the totality of consciousness is the designer of the universe, and the universe is made of consciousness, so it just goes into that whole, you know, superposition, quantum entanglement, you know, sort of everything existing at once, you know, kind of an idea. That, you know, the creator and the created are one and the same. You know, that sort of stuff. And it gets into just really crazy math and shit, so.
That, I know I'm capable of learning about that and everything, and I know it's a process, but I'm just saying right now, when you say the things like quantum entanglement and superposition, I 1/4 get what you're talking about. Other than that, it's like a complete blank space. I mean, I'm fascinated by it, but I mean, sometimes it just doesn't always add up.
Well, things like quantum entanglement and superposition, as far as like understanding the basics of what they are, it's not really all that hard. It's actually pretty easy. But the fact that it's pretty easy is why it's really, really hard. Because we hear words like quantum entanglement and superposition, and our programming kicks in and says, oh, well, that's a fancy word that I'm really impressed with, and if I'm really impressed with fancy words, because you know the world is made of words, Because I think that and I believe that, that means that anything like that has to be difficult and it can't be easy. Therefore, if somebody tries to present it to me in a way that is easy, my mind's going to say, eh, no, tilt, invalid, confusion, crash. Mm-hmm. Get what I'm saying? So that's why you only one-fourth understand it. It's not that it's hard. It's because the fact that it's easy crashes your brain. Because your mind's trying to say, nope, words like quantum entanglement and superposition, those are fancy schmancy words, automatically implies difficulty. Don't give me anything easy. If you do, I'm going to have an operating system crash. So that's what the programming is kind of doing in your head.
Well, I'd like to learn more about it.
Oh, you will in due time. I've explained it over and over. I'll just keep doing it until eventually you clear enough programming that you're like, one day you'll be like, oh, that's what you mean. Now I get it.
Sounds like fun.
You've had that happen before to where I've explained something, you know, 999 times and, you know, on the frickin' 10,000th time, it finally clicks.
Yeah, that has happened.
And it's not that you didn't hear me the first 999 times. It's just that you finally got the constipated, you know, piece of poo out of your head and the data was able to flow through and click in all the right places, so it's like finally all the data points connected. You're like, oh, okay. It's not that you didn't hear me. It's not that you weren't paying attention. It's not that you were ignoring me. It's just it took what it took for the pipe to unclog.
Yeah. And sometimes, you know, I'll just get bits and pieces and... I think I'd like to get off of here soon and maybe go to bed. But it's been great talking. Obviously, it's been awesome discussion.
Say that last part again. It kind of faded.
There's been some awesome discussion, and I really enjoy just discussing these topics and getting some awareness out there. It's cool.
Well, it's been awesome to have you on again. Of course, yeah, that reminds me, we still got to do a Google Hangout about respecting your pace, and there's a bunch of other things that we were going to talk about that we won't talk about this time, but you already know what I'm referencing.
Yes, so if you would like
we'll hit that up next time. What?
Yes. Well, I was saying if people want a little bit more discussion about some other cool topics, hit up those Google Hangouts. It'll be really fun.
Yeah, I got all the different playlists and stuff on the Paradigm Shift channel, and it's organized fairly well, and I got everything separated as far as, you know, me and Kristen and Katarina and Rich and Jay, and, you know, we've all got our own playlists and then into subcategories like, you know, internet radio and Google Hangouts and things like that, and also separated by year, going from 2011 to 2015. So that's fairly well organized, fairly easy to navigate. People can find their way around pretty well. I don't think you've had any problems finding your way around, have you?
I have not. Whenever I have a particular video in mind, which I don't always, but I don't have too hard of a time finding it. So I say it's pretty fairly good organized. And I also do like the whole categorized by year thing, because I just think it's cool to pay attention to energy patterns within certain years. You know, I think that certain years have a certain, like you, well, you've talked about it before. Certain years have a certain theme that if you observe a little bit, you can kind of identify it.
Yeah. When people notice those types of patterns, they also need to realize that it's not like it shifts from one theme to another. Kind of, it's more like going through grades in school. It's not like you're replacing what you learned in first and second grade with third grade. you know, what you learned in first and second grade integrates into what you're learning in third grade. And I think, you know, there's a lot of people that kind of take it to extremes with the light switch thinking, so to speak, like, oh, well, we did this, and now we're in this now, so these things have nothing to do with each other, they're all separate. It's like, no, they're not. And then, like, they confuse the shit out of themselves because they're not putting the knowledge together. You know, they're like, okay, I was in that room, and now I'm in this one. It's like, no, that's not how it's working. It's about putting it together, not about swapping out. It's about bringing knowledge together and becoming more aware and more efficient with that. And it's about actually putting it to use. A lot, you know, like to quote Cryon, he said, light worker, it's time to do the work. Speaking euphemistically, of course. And I love how he busts on New Agers quite a bit. Because he elaborated, stating that all these New Agers just like to sit there and learn and meditate and whatever, but they don't do jack with their knowledge. They just like sit there and keep learning, but they never apply it because they're like afraid to step up and actually do anything. He said it's like someone taking 8 years of medical school, and then after they have their degree, it's like, all right, well, what are you going to do? It's like, oh, I'm going to take another 8 years of medical school. So they take another 8 years, and it's like, okay, you have your next degree. Well, what are you going to do? I'm going to take another 8 years. And, you know, they never end up really becoming the doctor. They just keep going back to medical school, going back to medical school, going back to, you know, and they never apply the knowledge. And he's saying that's like what a lot of these New Agers do, these so-called light workers. So he's like, light worker, it's time to do the work. You know, you've been sitting on your butts fucking learning and, you know, shining your light and holding space and whatever, and that was all good and fine and a necessary step, but, you know, it's time to do a bit more than that. It's time to actually apply it instead of, you know, sitting there in fucking woo-woo land. It's time to fucking get active.
That's kind of what I'm
It's all just lip service otherwise.
Yeah. That's the point that I'm reaching. Because I'm guilty of just taking in ideas and taking in ideas, and I...
Well, no, like, you're not guilty. You're just starting out. I mean, you've lived through what you've lived through. Most of the stuff is new, and you're taking your time and your pace to learn. I don't think you're quote-unquote guilty of any of that. You're actually respecting your pace.
Say, when I said guilty, I just meant I do that.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Well, I'm just saying you haven't really been in a position to be fully active yet. You know, you're slowly starting to get there, and you're learning to do it at your own pace instead of rushing, and that's fine. But there are some of these so-called spiritual people that have been at it for like 10, 20 years, and they're still sitting on their butts in wooey-wooey land, and it's like, come on. Oh, and it says we have one viewer.
I wonder who that is. Hello, and thank you.
Well, hello, Mr. or Miss One Viewer, but we're about to wrap this up since you're going to have to catch this from the beginning. We've been on here for quite a while, so there's lots to see. You've caught us at the end of it, sorry.
But, hey, there's nothing wrong with pacing yourself. Watch, you know, 15 minutes at a time or something.
Yep. But, yeah, it's this awesome. Is long frickin' video. I won't know how long until it's done processing because I didn't like take note of exactly when the start time was, but it's a long video and it covers a variety of things, and you know, more than three quarters of it contains a lot of useful information about the smart meters and stuff, so I think that's it's going to be enjoyable for people, I think, hopefully, maybe, possibly.
If I could bring up one thing.
Sure.
Just real fast.
Go right ahead.
One thing that I'm kind of nervous about is I know a lot of people, if a video is more than like 15 minutes long, you know, they won't watch it. And no, I know...
Not necessarily. Depends on the type of video.
And it depends on the person, too. And because I know in the past, even if I liked a video, if it got too long, I just turn it off. But what I think I'm going to do is when I put up longer videos like this on my channel, I'm just going to put a little reminder for some people. You know, you don't have to watch this whole video in one setting. Yeah. So you can just watch a bit, come back to it. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, there is nothing wrong with that. But, I mean, people that are, like, really into, like, there's a good demographic of people that love long videos, and they know this too well. You know, people that love sitting through, like, the two-hour documentaries and shit like that, like, discussions. Well,
it's like some people watching movies. It's just their kind of thing.
Exactly. Exactly. So, you know, those type of people will, you know, watch a big, long 2-3-4 hour whatever, and they might not do it in one sitting. You know, they might only watch part of it, and then they'll just remember where they were, and they'll pick it back up, you know, where they left off later or whatever. So, yeah.
And even if people don't want to do that and they just want to watch, you know, a few minutes or whatever, that's better than nothing. It's cool.
Yeah, I mean, I usually try to give an explanation at the beginning as to, like, what the videos, you know, what the hangout and stuff is going to be about, whatever, so that, you know, people can discern whether or not it's something that they want to, you know, continue watching, or whether or not they're not really, you know, they're not really interested and they just want to close out of it. I do my best to kind of give a bit, you know, an overview. I usually take about, you know, anywhere between 5 to 10 minutes doing it, but I just kind of want to be thorough, and, you know, it gives people an opportunity to decide whether or not they want to sit through this whole big long thing, or, you know, whether they want to be like, all right, I'm not interested, I'm out of here, you know, so.
Yeah, and I know lots of times you'll put together videos that aren't hours long because they're not hangouts.
Yeah, of course.
That's cool.
And I mean, you know, even, and there's stuff that I, you know, paste together and whatever in Caden Live, and some of them are an hour or two, and others are like 3 minutes, and others are 2 minutes, and others are 15 minutes. It really just all kind of depends.
Yeah, definitely. And the thing about the hangouts is it's a completely different ballpark, you know, hearing people discuss stuff.
Yeah.
Normal people. It's its own thing, and it's cool.
It's almost like a radio show in a way, only there's video options and on-screen presentations and things like that, but it's almost like internet radio in the sense that, yeah, you know, it's like talk radio almost. It's a discussion, and, you know, obviously when you know something's a discussion, it's a no-brainer that people are going to be sitting around talking about stuff. It's, you know, that's what you expect out of those sorts of things.
Exactly. So the kind of crowd that these Google Hangouts attract is oftentimes the whole internet radio crowd. And people like that.
Yeah, internet radios, stuff, documentaries, you know, that sort of thing. And, you know, a lot of times, like, you know, when I participate in radio shows or Katarina or Jay or whatever, I mean, I'll take radio show episodes. I'll put video to it. I'll upload it, you know, as a PSEC episode and whatever if it has to do with what we're dealing with. So, some of them literally are internet radio shows, and, you know, that's why I have a playlist for, you know, internet radio on there off the main page, because some of this is. Some of it is.
Sweet. And that's like, also cool, because when
Katarina was on Ever Beyond on Will Spirit Radio, you know, within, like, the last week or so, and That's one of the most recent ones. It talks about, you know, she's on with JP, and, you know, they're talking about, like, dealing with trauma and stuff like that. So, you know, how to, like, move through that. So that was one of the more recent ones.
I might have to check that out. Probably good.
Yeah, I can like, share it on your Facebook wall if you want.
Okay, cool. All right. Good night, Dave. And good night to this hangout and whatever viewer.
Good night, world.
Yes. It's been awesome.
Yes,
talk
it has.
To you later.
Too bad Rich had to leave so soon, otherwise he would have been here too, but he was on earlier, so anybody who is watching now who missed him, they can check back to the beginning, and it starts off with, you know, me and Rich talking, so.
Yes. And have a good one.
Yep, you too. Have a good night. Catch you later.
Bye.
Bye-bye.